Tänne on tullut lisää joukkoa. Tervetuloa uudelleen kaikille. So good afternoon everybody. I'm really sorry that we are a little bit late, but you know that the traffic is always unexpected. And anyway, welcome all our honored guests and actually Daniel Tolley, please, I want to introduce you. Daniel Tolley is the editor-in-chief in A Magazine, and he's the curator and moderator of this seminar. And now I give this stage to Daniel.
Thank you very much, Pirjo. Welcome, everybody, today to For Fashion's Sake. I'd like to introduce you to my wonderful guests and friends who I'm very happy to have around me today. And we're going to be talking to you and to each other about something that's perhaps a little bit more of a philosophical and social take on fashion today. And we have some perspectives from different countries, different backgrounds and different areas of not only fashion but the arts in general. So I'd like to start on the end here with Lutz, who is a German fashion designer based in Paris. We have Stephen Jones, the milliner from London, and Lou Stoppard from Show Studio. She's the editor of Nick Knight's Show Studio, also in London. Frances Corner, who is the dean of the London College of Fashion. Michel Gobert, the sound designer from Paris, France. And Ryan Aguilar, a recent Parisian and San Francisco native, and working with Michel. So we're going to today be sort of going a bit non-digital with our presentation for various reasons that I will explain. So what I have to start today's presentation is an essay that you all have in front of you in your program. And it's called The One True Philosophy of Clothes. So I'd ask you to turn and follow and as I read this piece, because I think it's an interesting way to start this discussion by taking clothes in a very overly serious way and a perhaps overly philosophical way. And then as we go through, I think we're going to lighten things up quite a lot and end in a very different way and different way of seeing the fashion business today. So this essay was actually published in Parenza Schooler's issue of A Magazine in 2009, and it's by Simon Critchley, who is the chair of philosophy at the New School in New York. So I'll begin with The One True Philosophy of Clothes. What is the human being? 25 centuries ago, Plato gave a lecture in the Academy in Athens where he defined the human being as an animal, a biped, and featherless. He was warmly applauded. Upon hearing this definition, Diogenes the Cynic, once described as a Socrates gone mad, left the lecture room, found a chicken, plucked it clean, and brought it back in the lecture theatre, declaring, "Here is Plato's man." Here's another better definition of the human being from the great 18th century satirist Jonathan Swift. In A Tale of a Tub, he writes, "What is man himself but a microcoat, or rather, a complete suit of cloths with all its trimmings. Without clothes, human beings are hideous. We're simply forked animals with bandy legs. Thus, clothes are necessary. But I'd like to go further and argue that clothes are essential and we might learn much from pondering their meaning. Ask yourself, what is a human being but a garment, and what is the world but the living garment of God? If language is the expressive garment of thought, then clothes are the expressive garment of the body. Nature and life itself are but one garment woven and ever weaving from the loom of time. As the earth spirit in Goethe's Faust says, and note that these words betray the fact that God himself is not naked, 'Tis thus at the roaring loom of time I ply, and weave for God the garment thou seest him by.' Or as Carlyle writes in Sartor Resartus, or The Tailor Retailored, 'The whole external universe and what holds it together is but clothing, and the essence of all science lies in the philosophy of clothes.' The philosophy of clothes is not some specialized sub-discipline taught in fashion school ghettos. It is the key to understanding everything. It is the germ and gem of all science. The human being is the fashioned animal, and fashion is the key to understanding the human being. Put simply, mankind equals mannequin equals mannequin. The fashion designer is not just the maker of clothes or purveyor of frocks. He is a creator, something almost divine. Like Plato's demiurge or creator deity in Timaeus, The fashion designer takes the old rags of matter and forms them into something sublime. God is the great fashion designer in the sky, and the fashion designers here on earth are his prophets, his true disciples, mortal powers to his immortal power. In our depressingly sick society, we must fashion a new garment, a new and splendid outfit to clothe the naked body politic, and it must be a beautiful garment. Against the dominant utilitarianism that reduces all human experience to a mechanism of profit and loss, governed by a crude hedonistic calculus, the body politic needs a sumptuous and gorgeous new frock. This is the eternal truth of dandyism, and what we might venture to call the dandyical body. Where most people dress to live, the dandy lives to dress. God loves dandies because, truth to tell, he is one himself. All forms of utilitarianism have to be refused through a refashioning of the human being through fashion. Dress and dress beautifully, for by doing so you are honoring the deity and becoming a little closer to the deity yourself. But not too close. Remember why it is that we need clothes. To cover our shame, of course. It is because Eve was tempted by the wily serpent and Adam tasted the forbidden fruit that we were forced to exit paradise. It is only with the fall and the fact of original sin that we felt shame in the eyes of God and covered ourselves with the first clothes, a tiny fig leaf. If our entire social order is based on covering our shame, then the world that we inhabit is based on the need for clothes. But here's the delicious and essential paradox. Clothes conceal and cover. They hide, but they also disclose. They reveal precisely by concealing. Think of the extraordinary importance of the slit, the hemline, the décolletage, of the symbolic phallic display of collar and tie. We see more in seeing less, or at least we think we do. This, of course, is a rigorously Heideggerian sense in the true function of clothing, its bivalent play of disclosure and concealment. Full nakedness is always a crushing disappointment because it extinguishes desire. It is only in concealment that desire is mobilized. It is only through the slit, through the dark recesses of what the slit conceals, that desire takes wing. It is only in not seeing that we desire to see, perchance to touch, even to taste. You might ask, am I serious in advancing this clothes philosophy as the single key to everything? My dear, I've never been more serious in my life. As Herr Diogenes Teufelsdroch counsels, we must pass from the everlasting no through the center of indifference to the everlasting yes. We can only begin to think this through if we seriously meditate on the meaning of clothes and give ourselves up wholeheartedly to their philosophy. And there finishes the one true philosophy of clothes. And in that, I hope you can take a little bit from what we want to talk about today and bring some of those rather perhaps ancient and classical ideas of dressing into a little bit more of a 21st century context and sort of think about that in the way that we are sitting today here in 2014 with guests from all over the world on a stage that will finally be broadcast on the internet. And our topic is For Fashion's Sake. And I'd ask my guests to take up their microphones to join me in the discussion now. Because what we're going to be talking about today is the word fashion. And we've blinked it out in the title because fashion, in a way, has become a dirty word. It's become something that means a lot of things. And at the same time, it means nothing. So what we're going to talk about is that very fact that certain things have become for the sake of fashion and perhaps not for advancing a true creativity within that. So I'd like to start with that note by actually explaining how we got here today with this little group. And it's actually probably been it's been the hardest edition of Pre-Helsinki yet to pull together for a lot of us. And there's been a few hiccups and bumps along the way. And one of those was on Saturday we found out the very sad passing of Professor Louise Wilson of Central St. Martin's, who would have been sitting here with us today had she not lost her battle to cancer this weekend. So we have a few speakers here who knew her well, and we've actually decided to dedicate today to Louise, and I'd actually like to just quickly ask. Lou was going to start with a little note about Louise, because she actually studied with her as well at St. Martin's.
Yeah, I was very privileged to learn under Louise. It's a very short thing that I'm going to say that is actually a famous quote that she said, where it was classic Louise. She was very good at sort of giving you something that was more more insightful and more useful in just one sentence, often shouted at you, than other people could say by talking to you and counselling you for sort of a very long time. And there's a very famous quote she said where said, "I don't know, I know what I don't want, but I don't know what I do want because I hope I haven't seen it yet," which I just think is a fabulous mantra by which to live all life, where what you really want you probably haven't encountered yet. She's a very, very wonderful woman, and it's a great loss, and I think all of fashion owes her a great debt. But I think it's important to live by that, to presume that you don't actually know what you want because you haven't encountered it. It gives life a lot of magic that way.
I was wondering if Stephen might have a Louise anecdote as well, perhaps.
Louise, hi everybody. A Louise anecdote. Well, she never taught me, but I do remember in 2009, I think it was, I received from the British Fashion Council an Outstanding Achievement Award. And she was at the British Fashion Awards, and I got this, and it was, you know, everybody in the industry was there. And there was this, at that time, I thought it was not particularly great ballet with my hats on. But, you know, I went with it, and everybody seemed to like it. Anyway, after the event, she came up to me, and she said, "What the fuck was all that about?" And I said, "Well, it was their idea." And she said, "Don't do that again, and try and improve on it next time." And you know what? I mean, she said it slightly as a joke, but at that point, that was supposed to be the high point of my career. And actually, to be taken down a notch was very healthy. And I have to say, I do think about it not every day, but once a week anyway. So that's my Louise anecdote. So she's still here in a funny way.
That's fantastic. I believe Lutz also has a couple of things to say about her.
Well, she never taught me either. She never taught me either, but what happened was I did the BA at St. Martin's, and at the time it was all still in one building, so we used to go past her office, and she'd be in her office with the door closed and scream at people. And we just walked past being really scared of her. And what she did sometimes is when the door was half open, you'd walk past and she'd scream at you to come in and give her a cigarette, because she wasn't supposed to smoke, neither in the building nor with her health. But she didn't care, and that was very much Louise. The thing is that once I left St. Martin's and went to Paris to work, so I never did the MA, but we became really good friends, and I went back to St. Martin's to teach. And she turned out to be the most wonderful, lovely, gentle person. And it was funny, because when we could hear her scream, you'd never think that she could be like that. But she had this incredible personality where she was literally 360 degrees. She was everything. She was the most amazing, intelligent, lovely person. But she was very harsh as well. She was brutally honest. And she would always tell you the truth, whatever it was about. And you could just take it. But you knew that whatever she said to you was true, and it was what nobody else might say to you. So she will be greatly missed.
So moving on from that most famous swearing professor, we should also take into account that approach to fashion as something very very real and very balancing between the pragmatism of being a designer and all the other facets that there are in the industry. And we have Frances with us today, who is the head of London College of Fashion, which is a different kind of school, and maybe you can explain a little bit how you approach the teaching of fashion today, not just in terms of design.
Yeah, I mean, everybody will know St. Martin's is a sister college to London College of Fashion. We're all part of the University of the Arts London. And one of the things that I think was very extraordinary about what the university was able to offer was that, and still does, although obviously with Louise going, we're all going to have to take an intake of breath and think about it, because it allows us to encompass everything that fashion is and how fashion might be taught. And she was a great colleague, challenging and difficult, but also really wonderful. So she's going to be missed, you know, not just by people within fashion, but also people from other subject disciplines. And I think that's one of the things that's interesting about London College of Fashion, because very often fashion is taught in the faculty of art and design or with other subject disciplines around it. What we have at London College of Fashion is that we are a monotechnic within a monotechnic, because obviously a university of the arts is all about art and design and communication disciplines. And that gives us some really extraordinary opportunities, because there are about 5,500 students at the London College of Fashion, and everything that you can possibly think of is studied there. So we do have journalism, PR, creative direction, buying and merchandising, bespoke tailoring, footwear. And it means that students come to us because they want to be part of a college that encompasses all aspects of the discipline. And we are able to, I think, from the outset, really promote the fact that the fashion industry is so much about a collaborative experience. The idea that as a designer, you make it on your own. I'm sure you're all beginning, you realize that that isn't the case. You need to work with a whole team and to collaborate, particularly now, because with technology and all of those aspects, it's not just your design, it's also how you brand it, how you market it, you know, how you Instagram it, you know, how you write about it, how you photograph it. And that gives a whole set of extraordinary possibilities, but also, I think, some great challenges, both for us as institutions, but also for all of you who are going to go out and work in what is now an extraordinary industry. Because, you know, as Dan and I have often sort of spoken about quite recently, within this maelstrom that is fashion now, what is fashion? And I think that is something that is students and graduates, it's really important for you to be thinking about, not just as the essay about the philosophy of clothes, it's also about your philosophy about how you're going to work within what is an extraordinary industry now.
And the complete practical side of everything. Yes. And that collaborative nature is something that Michelle, you also have experienced a lot of, and it's something that we were talking about over the weekend, of course, how you have different experiences with different designers, and that what you bring to a show as a music designer can give a completely different idea to a collection and an extra dimension to it that is perhaps lost today with the internet.
Well, hello everybody. Well, it's true, because you know what I do, maybe it's not really fashion, but it's part of the fashion experiment, you know, the fashion experience. And making music for a show is also giving it another dimension to what you see. So whether it's in the designer's mind or whether it's like in between, when we talk between each other, when you see a fashion show and we decide to have a certain soundtrack, it's not we are just playing our favorite songs. It's like, because the music is supposed to mean something with the image. It's like a video clip. It's like a movie. So depending on the designer you work for, I mean, some of them are very inclined to go behind their own taste or behind what they really like, you know, to use some music that they feel is like the best way to carry across the message. And sometimes, you know, you sometimes, how do I say that? Sometimes, you know, you have to push yourself, because it's not, you know, you like something, so, oh my God, this is so good, I want to play this. You know, you have to be aware that maybe 1,000 people are going to watch this, and you have to make sense of about everything. You know, it's like, it's also a reflection on the time, you know, of on our time, what we're going through. It's a reflection, like, you know, what it means to show fashion now. What, is it relevant? Is it not relevant? It's not also about playing the newest music, because it doesn't mean anything. Like, any one of us can listen to the newest music. Now you go on the internet and you find all the good stuff. So it's a complicated process, and it's part of what you're saying in the college. You know, it's like fashion now. It's like a big thing that incorporates sound, image, vision, like branding, you know, like also we were talking about the Instagram, and the Instagram is also another dimension, you know, for designers to express themselves. And we just talked about it in an interview I did for a magazine called System, you know, by Instagram. And they asked me a question like, why is it so important for them to have an Instagram account? And I think it's important for them because they do what they want. Then they're free. It's not such a corporate image, like such a corporate thing when that they do within the brand. So you have people like, we got our T-shirt, takes pictures of maybe like, you know, at night in the club, or like people on the beach. I mean, it's just like, you know, telling something else, you know, and I think it's also very important to me now that people express themselves as persons, even when they work within a big brand, you know, because they're not robots and they're not like, okay, they have a soul to them. And I think it's important that all of this comes across, because maybe I'm talking too much, but I think that fashion, as you said, has become a big maelstrom, like it's a big melting pot, and I don't think it's clear for a lot of people what fashion is now, you know? So to me, it's stuck in some kind of like weird thing, you know what I mean? It's getting maybe too big for all of us.
Completely, and I think that human side that designers are showing through their through that window of Instagram is very important. It completely ties into our main topic today, which is the fact that fashion is a complement to lifestyle and to the person that we want to express and who we want to be seen as. And it's not just itself a collage upon collage of layers of clothing. I think that what's the really important issue for us to discuss is that for the younger generation today, that clothes have become much less symbolic of what they once were and much more to do with a status symbol and a luxury symbol rather than actually pertaining to any sort of subcultural context and any sort of group and identity outside of that. And I'd like to actually pose the next question to Ryan, because he's perhaps somebody who's come into this discussion a little bit more outside of the sphere of this European fashion circuit and from more art background. How do you see this kind of the network and the sort of perhaps the social set, like we saw in Monte Carlo this weekend? Like what's your impression of why people dress and what it kind of what they're trying to say with that?
Hello, hi. Well, you're right. I kind of got catapulted, into another continent and into a very different scene that I was coming from, which was contemporary art and music, but some fashion also, a very different maybe type of dress code. But I think to answer what was happening in Monte Carlo, I mean, fashion on that level is, we're talking about a luxury market, you know, and so there's, you know, much more about, the textiles and craft, you know, at a level that's, you know, the very cutting edge of technology, you know, and avant-garde, you know, I guess like contemporary art, you know, new movements and new ways of putting things together, you know, that are very exciting. Plus the whole presentation and packaging of all of that, you know, we saw in the three cruise collections that were happening with Chanel, Dior, and, it was an exciting
with those women that, just to explain a little more, so Michelle and Ryan have done the entire circuit of the three cruise collections that have just taken place between Dior in New York, Chanel in Dubai, and Louis Vuitton in Monte Carlo this weekend. So so I was kind of interested in terms of those women as particularly that have become such symbols in the industry and that are dressed by brands and all of this sort of thing, and what that comes to actually mean in any sort of wider sense of cultural meaning.
Well, I think you kind of maybe hit on that initially with the word maybe statusy. I mean, there's a lot of that kind of dripping off, you know, in a sometimes a ham-fisted way, sometimes put together more eloquently, mm-hmm. you know, sometimes beautifully, you know. But you know, there was a lot of branding going on, and you know, sometimes with finesse, and sometimes not so much. But it was interesting, you know, to see that, and very colorful and great and grandiose, and all those words, you know, were happening there on the scene as they were arriving, you know, the procession mm-hmm. of that and how people put it together and how they kind of see what it means to them, you know, on an individual basis, you know, one by one, you know, you can kind of see groups or clusters of people, even groups coming in together. Maybe they all had sort of a way of saying a similar thing as they came in with groups of people, you know, kind of what camps they were with, what tribes mm-hmm. they were kind of traveling in within that subculture under that umbrella, you know, of luxury.
So fashion and luxury itself is, in a way, its own new subculture.
Yeah, of course. I mean, there's like that larger umbrella, and then within that, there are ways of putting it together. And it was all kind of illustrated in camps, I felt like, you know, to some degree.
And with Cannes also going on at the moment, it's another huge window into this kind of luxury mechanism that has kind of taken over why designers are designing what they are making, and it's to dress particular women that have these huge followings that will inspire other women to want those clothes without a necessary perhaps idea behind them. Do you agree?
Yeah, it's interesting. I was thinking we've talked a lot about that kind of those women and that style and those kind of women that are outside shows or at these kind of events, and we were also talking about Instagram. And if you think about Instagram, I think at its core, it's meant to be almost like a vehicle for street style in a way. It's meant to, you know, almost a visual diary, you document what you're wearing each day. And I think all of it, when you put it together, there's been some interesting pieces written about this recently. It really does, I think, illustrate kind of the death of street style. You also talked about, you know, the lack of subcultures that we're seeing now and people not dressing kind of in a tribal way. And I think you really do see that on Instagram now, as it's almost become as sort of curated and organized and branded as the shows themselves. You know, you very rarely actually see those women that have those huge followings on Instagram or those huge street style followings. They are wearing head-to-toe looks. You know, they're not wearing things that are particularly sort of original or personal to them. And I think that's very interesting, that kind of the control and the way that luxury has now moved fully into the street. And you always think, where is the originality and individuality going to come out when Instagram is such a kind of vehicle now, and you can make an incredible amount of money off your Instagram and it can propel your career to new heights. And
it's scary, isn't it?
Yeah, it's scary, but it's also interesting. It makes me wonder where we're going to see the real kind of authenticity in the street pop up now that the internet has become almost so sort of sanitized and so controlled, which is almost ironic when you think that the internet should be so sort of about freedom and individuality, but you're not seeing that anymore. You know, it's all head-to-toe looks.
Was that the word? I'm sorry.
Go on, I have an anecdote, you know, because I was working on the Chloe show in Paris last March, and I arrived in the Chloe show, and I got late to my show because there was like a big mob on the street. I thought it was maybe like Nicole Kidman or like, you know, some very famous movie star on the street. It was Mira Dumas, who has a blog, you know, like a Russian blog, posing on the street, and there was at least 200 people taking pictures of her. I was blown away because I was like, who is Mira Dumas in the end? You know what I mean? I mean, I have nothing against her, but it's like, I thought she was someone famous or maybe like the Queen of Japan. I don't know, someone was going to be there. But it was just Mira Dumas wearing head-to-toe looks, and people were fighting to get her picture. And I think it's wrong anyway, like in the scope of fashion. I think it's taking it to a level that, you know, it's not cool.
It's interesting as well, isn't it? Because you think that brands, you know, they control. There's so much kind of outrage about brands controlling styling, you know, saying that magazines and stylists have to shoot head-to-toe looks, and that's such a thing of controversy, and everyone's saying that all the creativity is being taken out of fashion. But actually, it's the very same people that are kind of moaning about that and saying that magazines aren't creative that are wearing a head-to-toe look outside the shows. You know, that's become as controlled as the editorial pages. It's interesting.
Going back to the word you used before about tribes, I think that's quite a key sort of catchphrase in actually describing certain modes of fashion at the moment. And I think it's funny to think about that and whether to get us into the next sort of part of the talk is to think about clothing and the reasons behind what people are actually making at the moment, and whether this tribal idea of fashion, whether it really has any sort of gumption behind it, when we talk about what Ricardo is making with very printed sort of flat 3D printed flat sort of placement designs, and then also Rick Owen's work is also being described as tribal as well. I'd like to sort of open up that sort of melting pot as well, and I think... Stephen, go ahead.
But actually, what you're talking about here is fashion from fashion designers. And there's a whole load of fashion and clothing out there which is not from fashion designers, which is completely about tribal dressing. I mean, the reason why skaters in LA dress in a certain way is because they want to feel part of a group. People have always wanted to associate themselves just for that sense of belonging, you know, whether they were a caveman all wearing the same color of fur, so they belonged to that group. And then the next, in the next cave, they had a different color of fur. To whether, I mean, I have to say that we, apart from myself, we're all a tribe here because we're all wearing black. You know, we're fashion people. I actually went and got changed and put a bright color on, so I wasn't part of the group. No, to confess.
Thank you. You completely hit the nail on the head of the entire reason we're here is to talk about exactly that idea and the fact that a lot of that fashion design itself has become so disconnected from those very ideas that you just brought up.
I think a lot of those people actually became fashion designers. Mm. You know, if you think of Rick, yeah, I mean, he was very much about his own personal street style with Michelle as well. And then he made real fashion out of it. You know, Carl came from a very different place. He was somebody who really studied fashion and then became a fashion designer.
And I think that's interesting because those people, there is an absolute authenticity to them, and that's why they are so successful in what they do as well. But I think it's interesting to take those as the case studies and then sort of consider the customer of those people today and whether those customers are necessarily understanding from where comes their, you know, their sneakers, why they're wearing that kind of style of leather jacket or perhaps a Perfecto even.
I think, you know, often sort of they don't have a clue.
That's what
but
I mean.
I think at the same time, if you went back to the, say, the 60s, funny enough, I love this bit where it says, you know, well, actually I haven't got my glasses on, so I can't read it. It says the thing about God is the greatest designer in the world or something. God is the great fashion designer in the sky. I always thought it was Balenciaga, but still. but you know, at that in those days, you know, people didn't know the references to fashion. They didn't know the fact that it was when Balenciaga took a design, it was reflecting modern art or it was reflecting 15th century Indian. Now what's happened is that, yes, the story behind it, the story of who makes the hats, who makes the music, is suddenly, you know, consumed as well as well as the final product. So people are interested in the background. People are interested where they came from. I don't really think that people think, oh, yeah, it's just a black shirt. The added value that people put into clothing is either because it's luxury, so that's, you know, the premium buzzword, or, you know, the sort of social thing which comes from behind wash silk or a little leather strap or a neckerchief. I think people are interested in that.
But do you think that interest, do you think that interest has made people less excited about dressing to kind of be part of a tribe, as we talked about before? You know, people are more interested in the individual nature of their clothes. They want to buy something because it's expensive or luxury or because they want to be associated with Karl Lagerfeld rather than because they want to be part of, like, a skater gang. I feel like, I wonder if that's come from the internet as well. People are less gangy in how they buy stuff.
Yeah, I think
you're very excited there.
Yeah, no, no, because I think what's happened is that fashion has just become one big tribe, and people don't know why they wear certain things. I think whereas before, when we were putting things on, it was because it was saying something about ourselves. Now all it's saying, in a way, is I'm being part of this whole big thing, and that's enough. And it's really great in a way that it's enough because it also gives you an identity. Whereas before, it was much more difficult to find or to have an identity that was personal, whereas now you can, like, everything is up for grabs and you can take whatever you want and it all means the same in a way. And it's funny because we see, like, the Perfecto, for example, that used to mean something very specific at one point. Now it means now it just means that it's a leather jacket that is kind of slightly biker style, whereas I don't know, 10-20 years ago it meant that you were a certain person, or it meant that you were living maybe a certain life, that you were enjoying certain things. Now it's all just become of these things where all these signs are being mixed around. And in the end, it means all and nothing. And I'm not even sure whether that's a good or a bad thing. And in a way, when I first started, I always thought it's good to mix everything because that's where we're going. Now I feel like maybe we're mixing too much. Yeah. So it's difficult to judge.
There's that amazing Withnail and I quote where they say they're selling hippie wigs in Woolworths. And I think it's kind of like that. You know, you can get any subculture and you can just get it. And you don't need to know the meaning, you can just buy it.
I remember many, many years ago in London, there was this sort of clothing market, and there was a fantastic neon sign. And there were lots of different signs. It wasn't Kensington Market, but one very similar. And there was this wonderful sign which had a big neon arrow, and it said, "More designers this way, going down to the basement." And this is very much, you could take, you know, whatever you want.
Yeah, that's right.
I think the other thing that's quite interesting, and as people know, Yohji Yamamoto often talks about the fact that fashion has become so much to do with styling at the moment, and what he's interested in is the idea of, you know, great design and really thinking about creating a new way of thinking. And a lot of what was being said in that essay also resonated with him, because he obviously talks about concealment and the way that you design around the body. And I think that so much of what happens now is that I think there's a difference between fashion and consumption, and we've become so much of a consumerist society that we just buy it and we don't necessarily think about it. We see it's in the ether, it's there, it's part of what we're supposed to be wearing, so we buy it, we don't think about it, and the designers are under so much pressure to do things quite quickly on this amazing cycle that maybe they don't have the opportunity to stop and rethink, to say something new with clothes and to say something new with the extraordinary resources that we've got. It's like almost the more we've got, you think about all the digital, you think about the laser cutters, you think about, you know, the extraordinary sort of techniques that are evolving, yet we don't seem to be doing anything extraordinary with that. We seem to be doing something that's quite quick and easy. And I think, again, there's a lot of opportunity. I feel as though we're in this bit to create ourselves out of it. I don't think that, you know, it will get faster and faster and less. I think we all stop and begin to become dissatisfied. And so what is luxury? It could be a paper dress that you can only wear once because nobody else has got it. Or it could be that, you know, as saying Lou and I were talking about it earlier, it could be on Instagram. Actually, you create your own look and Instagram it. It could be something that you can't actually walk around in because you've, you know, there's no other way of saying something new and different. And I think that as human, I hope that as humans, we're resourceful enough to become dissatisfied and want to have more originality coming back in rather than less.
I think that's where we're all going to, you know. I mean, that's where we all, I think that's where we all aspire to be, because, like, when you think about fashion now, and it's like, for me, there's two kind of fashion. There's people who dress with, like, all the pages of ads they see in the papers and all that kind of stuff. So they want the whatever bag, their Prada bag, their money bag. So they know they have the right thing for the season, and they bought their thing, and it's like a status thing. And there's people who dress with fashion from wherever because they like to wear fashion. They like to make it their own, you know what I mean? And it's like, and so I think since the 90s, like, it's been with the power of all the super companies, you know, that we all know, I mean, and all the power of branding, this has become like the status thing. Has been like, you know, it's been terrible. Like, some stores you go to, oh, we don't have this in stock. You have to be on the waiting list. I say, I don't deal with that. If I don't have that, I'll get something else. You know what I mean? It's like, and these days are over. Like, you know, you don't want this kind of thing. You want to be yourself. You know, and with all what's given to you in fashion, the most important is that you consume it in a way to be yourself. You don't need to be a coat hanger from any of those brands. You know, and it's going to be very difficult for them. It also goes back to the cruise collections. Like, you know, for us, it's been very extreme to see those three shows, like, and they spend so much money, they make so much effort, you know, because they want to, you know, they want to be more singular, they want to detach themselves from the rest of the herd, you know what I mean? And because they know they have to fight, you know, to put their image across. I'm not saying that, I mean, they're doing nice things, that's not what I mean, you know, but it's like, and I think the game is going to become more and more complicated to be more singular and more personal.
Can I ask Frances a question? Yes. I was really interested by what she was saying, and also what Michelle was saying there about kind of money and all the technologies and all the resources that we have available to us, and I wondered, do you both think that that's making it even harder to have a personal connection with your clothes, because it's always about the technology or the laser cutting or the fabric, and it's never about does it fit you properly or does it suit you or do you like it. It's more about the garment is almost treated with more respect than the shopper themselves. I wonder if you think that as well.
I don't know. I mean, I think it's really, I think the challenge is about people, you know, as I said in the essay, developing your own philosophy about clothes that work with you. And I think that where you have got some of these extraordinary laser cut clothes, you know, that does give you all sorts of opportunities to say things, but it's not, I think the big problem is this head-to-toe look.
Yeah.
You know, you said, oh, I've got the whole of the Yves Saint Laurent, and I've got the whole of that, and, you know, I've just gone and bought the Prada dress, and, you know, in fact, I can only wear it once, because once I've worn, everybody's seen me wearing it, and it's so distinctive, you know, and so I think that I think is the problem, that somehow it's about the status and the money, not about the clothes, which is the thing that's really sad. And I can remember Peter York came and gave a talk. I mean, he's very much a sort of market researcher. He's also written a lot of commentary about style, particularly back in the 80s. And he was saying, you know, how come we've got so much choice and how come everybody looks so boring? You know, everybody looks somehow within the democratization of fashion, somehow something has been lost and it's been sort of dumbed down, for want of a better way of describing it. I sometimes think it's because it's so easy. People have got money. They don't really care. They don't really give it much thought. And we say a lot about ourselves, not just through our clothes, but the restaurants, the holidays, the films. You know, it was a time when actually how you dress was perhaps all you could say about yourself. So people really thought about that. And perhaps then would actually customize things and work with the techniques rather than just buying the look and putting it on, and that was it.
But social media has kind of replaced that. As you said before, you needed your T-shirt to say what band you're into or what politics you have, whereas now you can just write that on Twitter and you don't need your clothes in the same way.
Yeah. I think it also, I mean, it's quite interesting to hear what Stephen also mentioned earlier about the people that do care about these things, because I think it's absolutely true that there's two parties that we're discussing at the moment, and one is the party that is the more informed lover of fashion and the customer of fashion, and I think it's important to take them into high account, because in the end those are the ones that true designers are designing for and care about, and the reason that they do go to the mad lengths that designers do go to make amazing things. But at the same time, what we're faced with is the masses that are just hitting follow and are just having no idea or even care about what they're buying into and happy to be in the total look. And I think it's good that everyone sort of acknowledges those both sides.
I mean, not that we want to get into a total look conversation, but a couple of years ago, I met up with this lady called Amanda Burden, who used to be buying director of Harvey Nichols in the 80s. I had a very interesting conversation with her, and she said at that time, people would buy the complete look. And the biggest problem for them was they would buy the dress and the coat, but if they didn't have the matching shoes, they couldn't actually sell the rest of the outfit. And so there was a nightmare because they couldn't get in the right size. Because if you were spending a fortune and buying a Gautier or a Mugler or a Montana look, why wouldn't you want to wear all of it? Isn't, like, not wearing part of it, like, shortchanging yourself and not really... It's almost like buying a painting and covering up one corner. What's the point? So that was
the mauve leather shoes and the mauve leather handbag to exactly match as well.
yeah, exactly. But there was a sort of appreciation of luxury versus mass and why we're buying things is what we're talking about. There's I don't know if any of you read The Business of Fashion. You should all be. Imran is an extraordinary author. But there was a great article this morning about Michael Kors handbag selling for $300. And how he can do, you know, affordable luxury. And this is, you know, everywhere in the media they talk about affordable. And why is it that we feel we belong? And they're saying, you know, affordable luxury is $300. Well, actually, you can get a plastic carrier bag from a supermarket and carry something in that. If it's just a container, why is it that we spend that $300 to belong to the group?
Can I just add one? I think that example is really interesting. When you think about market positioning and the different types of companies, because everybody will know that Mulberry tried to go upmarket with their bags and charge a lot more, and of course they completely lost it. The people weren't prepared to do it. So that idea about where do you pitch what it is, companies may all have aspirations to keep chasing, you know, the high-end spenders, but actually people are quite savvy and know what they want and what they're prepared to do, and also that $300 handbag becomes, you know, one of the must-haves rather than being on the waiting list for a £12,000 Hermes. People would rather be really cool and say
$50,000 Hermes.
Yeah, yeah. I know, but like also, you know, I was noticing like since the early 90s, I went to work to Milan, like, you know, discovering fashion in Italy. And in those days, there was only like two places where you could get like a $1,200 bag, you know. Now you go down the street, Via Montepalo, and like everyone is fighting to sell a $1,200 bag. And there's not that many customers who can buy one. So what's the point, you know? And also this word affordable luxury is really bad. Affordable luxury, I mean, it's like luxury shouldn't be affordable. It's what you make it. You know what I mean? It's like it's very – it's not nice to people. Well, we have affordable luxury. Like, okay.
You mentioned to me earlier just the fact that fashion itself as an entity and apart from the whole, you know, wave that has currently surrounded it with the internet, that fashion itself and those that are really doing it at the top should become more exclusive.
Of course. I think it's very important because anyway, like, now there's a show going on for any luxury house in, like, maybe 2 minutes after the show is finished, the whole world can see it, you know. And I don't think it's good. I think that all these people should protect themselves because, I mean, they're truly working in luxury business. I mean, like, you know, all the people we mentioned earlier, they do amazing clothes. They do, like, in great lengths, like working with Stephen, like embroideries from the stars, like, you know, I mean, then it's not something they do overnight, you know what I mean? And like, and then they give it away like that, just to the whole world. And then people who sit like anywhere in the world, they just judge it from the front. They don't see the show, they don't see the 3D, they don't see the print, they don't live the experience, and they just slam it or love it for somewhat reason, you know. And I think you have to, I think for the people who come to the show, so you have to live the experience, you have to say it, you know what I mean? And I think it's like fashion is like killing itself, you know. You know, it's like a snake eating itself out. You know, I think it wants too much of the apple. Yeah.
What I always wonder about is how it's so everywhere, but how many people can actually buy all these things? Because before, I remember there wasn't that much advertising, and it wasn't all about luxury brands. Whereas now everything is about luxury brands. And I was coming home from the airport the other day, going with a cab via La Chapelle, which is one of the poor areas in Paris. And there was a big advertising about the new Celine shop opening. And in this area, where literally people have no money at all, you have this incredible image of Celine, which is beautiful, and the shop is opening. And I thought, is there one single person in all this area that actually wants to know that the Celine shop is opening somewhere? And if they want to know how... I mean, it seems so weird that it was never this... present.
Being shoved down everybody's throats all the time, and on well, you can't go on YouTube. Your YouTube account is already completely engineered to show you fashion ads if you're constantly working through Google on fashion and all those kind of things.
But I mean, that's why, in a way, I sometimes think you need another word for fashion, because in a way, fashion has become everything, and it's something to do with, you know, as we talked about, lifestyle, culture. Style, all of those that we're saying as human beings. You know, it's a bit like absolutely coming back to what Stephen was saying about the caveman. In a way, we're just a more, well, not necessarily more advanced, but more, it's apparently more sophisticated. We just don't all wear furs all the time. But the idea that actually, you know, we've all somehow brought our economies up. I mean, that's the other thing that's extraordinary about fashion, is that in terms of garment production or shoe production, you know, that is the thing that is one of the great economic generators for countries. And then I think you've got over 200 fashion weeks that take place around the world. It's like somehow you've arrived as a country or as a city if you have a fashion week, if you are sophisticated. So there's something, there's a sort of combination of things that have gone on, which I don't think anybody would want to reject. I think it's the same in contemporary art. I mean, there are the same sorts of discussions going on in art circles. You know, when you have so many art fairs, you've got so many galleries, you've got so many international artists, it's the same, you could say the same in terms of restaurants. You know, every city wants to have, you know, at least two or three restaurants with a Michelin star or whatever. It's something to do with us.
It's the level
beings
of human
wanting.
Expectation has just arisen and risen.
It's a sort of,
it
is, yes. But I think then what that actually means at the heart of those disciplines or subjects is the thing that's really important. And that's the big question back to all of us, I think, you know, when you're passionate about it, what does that mean?
Well, there's too much of everything anyway, so too many magazines, too many movies, too much of everything, and like you can't, you know, you can only like 1% maybe, you know, as an individual or even as far as your intellectual capacity goes. I mean, you cannot give yourself to all the production that's around you. You know, it's impossible, and there's too much crap.
Yeah, I'm so interested in what you were saying, Michelle, about you know how everything is consumed so quickly. You know, designers spend months and months and months on a collection, then you can see it all in these really blurry, bad Instagrams really quickly. But also, it's something we were all talking about before. I think what's interesting is not just how that affects the culture of fashion and the culture of sort of fashion communication. It's how it affects design as well, because there are actually designers who now design just because they know that the front matters, or they design like. You know, I chatted to Jonathan Anderson, J.W. Anderson, and he quite openly admits, you know, he designs things in blocks because it looks good online. When you see it on style.com, you know, he'll do it in threes.
He's not the only one.
But also, like David Comer, he always talks about designing with his digital eye. Yeah. You know, so he'll see it with his design eye, and then he'll see it with his digital eye. And I think it's interesting because I think there's a lot of talk about how that's affected fashion communication, but I don't think there's enough talk about how that the way things are only viewed from the front and they're only viewed in a very static, flat way, how that's physically affected design. I think that's really interesting as well.
Well, I think Miuccia Prada knows a lot about, you know, also this kind of thing, because all the past collections are very graphic from the front, so it looks amazing when you look at the show. You say, my God, it looks so good. But then the 3D version is like, you know, but people are becoming expert at this, you know, so they get the most press, they get the most image because you see the front of the items. And I think it's affecting a lot of people too. I mean, I know some other designers that they know to style a look perfectly, so it's picture ready, you know. But I noticed that maybe 6-7 years ago, working with Nicolas Giscard Balenciaga, he made one of the most beautiful collections, and all the backs of the clothes were so incredible with like cascades of fur, like inserts and the whole thing. You didn't see it once on any review or any websites. You didn't see one back of the garment at all. And it was the most amazing part of the collection. And that really got me mad.
It's really depressing as well, because I feel like sometimes writers don't actually write about the backs because they know that the viewers can't see it. So they don't even, like, even though that's their job as a critic, is almost to, you know, explain and talk about the collection. And, you know, the old role of a critic used to be to tell the public about what was going on. They're like, well, they won't be able to see it anyway, so I can't be bothered to try and explain it, and they'll just talk about the front. It's quite strange, isn't it?
And there's also another thing, I think, like, you know, since, you know, the fashion industry, which is also a word I don't like. I didn't work in the fashion thing because of the fashion industry. It's been, like, fairly recent for me. But since they're all doing so well in the Middle East and China, which are new markets for them, And they see their clothes are selling a lot. Like when they do something I would call maybe ugly or like not relevant, it sells so much. I think it probably alters also the way they think about their design and the way they should do things. Because they say, my God, this one sold so much. We should do something like that. And then it becomes uglier or weird, whatever you want, because it doesn't affect us. I mean, I'm not saying it's bad taste or whatever. It's like it's a different thing, you know. And I think it's kind of changing where they're coming from, and they get affected by that.
Those cultural and business drivers are absolutely affecting what people are putting out on the runways,
sure.
But I have to say that's been happening for a long time. I know that even in the late 40s, Christian Dior had an American PR manager. Because he understood what clothes would translate into American magazines. So say, for example, that not so much the new look, but there were certain other looks in sort of 1949, which were very geometric, which they knew that Penn and Avedon could take very good pictures of, and that's what went into the press. So in fact, what's going on with J.W. Anderson is not a new thing. I mean, I think it's probably become more refined and more pervasive, but actually the people who were clever way back then were doing exactly the same thing.
Yeah. It goes back to what I was asking about, like the lack of respect for the shopper, because if it's all just about looking good online, or it's all about getting more likes or followers, who's prioritising the wearer, the person that's actually going to buy it and live with it and put it on their body? I feel like that person...
And the one that has to wait 6 months to have that, not the one that gets to take it straight off the runway and wear it to that premiere.
I mean, I think the other thing that's a shame in all of this is that there is so much interest in the construction, you know, how things are made. And we often talk about the relationship of fashion to architecture, you know, because and engineering, because in the end, you know, the whole thing will fall to bits if you, you know, and you may not, people may not be, well, they are interested in the back, actually. You know, the fact that the journalists are lazy and don't promote it. And I think that that's, again, one of the, we have this great opportunity with social media and videos and films and things like that to be able to show the artisans and the construction. And certainly you think about Hermes and their website, and they show, you know, certain things being made. And that's what people get really excited about, because, you know, they can see that sort of construction and understand the skills that have gone into it, whether they can afford to buy it or not. And I think there could be much more that's done, which would then build up people's relationships with clothes, and then hopefully they would value them a bit more if they understood the work that's gone into making some of them.
I agree with you on that too, because I don't know if you remember, there was a documentary about Chanel called Signé Chanel that, you know, that a lot of people watched because it was so incredible. You could see, like, inside the atelier, and there was also this lovely woman, Mademoiselle Pouzieux. She was making all the, what we say in French, passementerie for the tailleur, and she was a farmer. She was living in a farm, and the people from Chanel used to go to her farm, and, like, she was, like, 85, and she was still, like, you know, taking the horses out and everything, and that night she would, like, you know, sew all the things on the Chanel jackets, and, like, and when people saw that, I'm like, God, it's real, you know, it really happens. And I also think it's nice that, you know, you see that there's some, like, real life coming into this. It's just not machines and, you know, just, I mean, fashion doesn't come from a tree, it doesn't grow in a field anyway, you know, you have, it's like there's life involved in it, you know, so I think it's, people like that, you know, it's just not like an industry, like we say, you know.
I think it's very interesting to see the people that are doing this, well, exactly what you're saying, in an intelligent and beautiful way, and the people that are perhaps falling off the boat there, and it shows how messy so many communications are, and so many houses are, and also how much of the press are. And I think something that we will all have to start really legitimizing again in the industry is that kind of beautiful craftsmanship and things to balance between having the correct amount of mystery and the correct amount of showing what's happening. Because the fact that many of us can subscribe to the feeds and to the Facebooks and to everything, and for these instant accounts, and then see, like, these horrible blurry pictures from a fashion show of some shoe that some American editor has decided to name, you know, her favorite shoe from the show, and then to see these, you know, snapshot finale videos, etc. And I mean, it's all just so.
It probably wasn't even her favorite shoe. It was just the one that she managed to get an in-focus picture.
It was blurry, exactly. And I think it's funny to see the way that some brands are so intelligently taking that back to some degree. At the Louis Vuitton cruise show, actually, what they did was launch directly. I mean, they can't avoid those editors at the shows doing that sort of thing. I was guilty of it myself. But they launched an editorial at the exact same time as the show to show the clothes in an editorial context entirely controlled by the brand, straight away, and in that way completely controlling their own image by saying, this is how we want, this is our runway setup, this is how we want the clothes to look in an editorial. This is the inspiration of the Monegasque coastline next to it with the sea anemones and the rocks and the flowers and everything, and that way. And then Carl does it as well, doesn't he, with his own photography after each of those shows. So it's interesting to see from that level and how that can and needs to filter down to every other kind of young brands and young people to actually show a bit more than these straight up and down lookbooks that get made to, you know, a dime a dozen, and everyone sees there's no kind of context given to the clothes. And if you can give it that really strong identity and context straight away, then it gives it such a lot more credibility, I think.
And it's more luxurious in a way, you know. Absolutely. It's more personal, because even if I write for them, sometimes I see that style.com killed fashion anyway, because, you know, it's like, given the fact that a show is 10 minutes and the photographers are like standing like this, you know, and I have to take the picture, and they know that right when they come out from the show, the picture has to be online. So they take the pictures as quick as they can. They don't look at them twice. They don't even retouch. If the light was bad, it just go online. And there you go, as like as a viewer online, and you say, oh my God, that looks like, God, that's so bad. Oh my God, that's really so bad. In fact, it was very nice, you know what I mean? So it's because it's all going too fast, and there's no thought, you know, put into it. And I think it's, if something can be done, I mean, that's, as far as, you know, projecting your image, I think, like, using people like that or doing stuff before or using your own images to show what you do, I think is far much better. As for the designer and also for the viewer, you know, it's not, I mean, all this fast thing is, it's not cool.
I wonder if the next development, I don't know if you've seen the magazine and online as well, to get more photographs in sideways, they're doing the crop narrower and narrower. So basically, if you do wide clothes, that's never going to be seen. Yeah, so maybe we're going to get very body conscious narrow clothes. And also, if we think of the number of outfits in the show, because an Instagram movie, how long can that be?
15 seconds.
15 seconds. So all you need to do, if you're taking a film of the finale, which is what it's all about now, you only need to have enough girls that can go past in 15 seconds.
You've That's solved fast fashion. Haven't you?
Yeah.
It's interesting. Just this is something I wanted to say kind of a bit before, but with this idea of stuff online as well, And it's almost, I think it's interesting you say people don't retouch, because it almost doesn't matter online anyway, because there is this sense that all you can do when you're responding to it as a viewer is like or not like. You know, there's not even that much degree of kind of going, but what's going on there? Or I can't see that properly. You just kind of, you like it or you don't like it. And we were having a giggle before, because just going back to the idea of the shopper, I was talking to Mary Katranzu, and she was saying how a lot of her shoppers come to her. You know, before, I imagine, women would go to a designer and they'd say, you know, oh, I wore it to a wedding and everyone told me I looked so beautiful and I was so happy and I felt really great or something like that. She said that women come to her and they say, oh, I'm so happy I bought your dress. I put it on Instagram and it got more likes than any other photo I've ever put up. And that's kind of how we judge stuff now. It's absolutely terrifying. It's your favorite fact.
It's just amazing, vision of fashion now.
Yeah.
And it is fashion now.
Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of people, I mean, there's whole philosophical studies going on about how to get the best, the most likes on your picture and the composition and the texture and the color and everything that really attracts sort of the eye instantly like that. And that's
well, the British Fashion Council even encouraged designers to have Instagrammable moments at their shows. It was actively encouraged to have a great set or like something fun on the seats, you know, something that would encourage...
Jazz it up.
Yeah, exactly. Something that would encourage buzz. And you can't kind of fault that in some way. You know, you're like, good on the British Fashion Council. They're trying to get London out there. They're trying to get people talking about it. And they're kind of working with the times. But then it is scary on the other degree that designers, you know, they're trying to make a collection as well as kind of like fashion some fantastic lollipop to put on the seats. It's quite terrifying.
Well, that sounds like a new job, like Instagram manager, you know, for a company.
That is a job, though.
It might already exist.
I can do that.
I have friends who do that job. Yeah. They have a great time.
But I think the other thing that's quite interesting is that everybody will know that the McQueen show Savage Beauty is coming to the V&A next year. And the tickets have already gone up. So a year before it's actually going to be opening, they're selling the tickets because they know there are going to be so many people. So it's not even, it's so pervasive now. And I think for a lot of museums, they're being pushed to do the big fashion show because they know that that's what's going to bring the audiences in and generate the money. So this idea, as you're saying, about, you know, fashion sort of eating itself, it's not just even within, you know, the sort of those who sort of know about it or the shows. It's all pervasive, really.
Well, that's what I think we're going to get into a little bit more in the second half of the talk, and that very fact that that fashion itself in this 21st century has never had more of a chance to be seen and to be and to be experienced and to be consumed by a bigger audience. It's just what it once was, and where it began was a niche group of people who had very specific tastes and wanted to sort of push that into textile and into creation. But now it's become such a part of the zeitgeist and it's consumed in very many different ways. And the fact that that was the best-selling exhibition, I believe, at the ever at the Met, is a testament to how it's just become so mainstream and how those things that these very niche, perhaps high-level things that we're talking about these special shows and things do get seen, and the messages, whatever they may be, do get taken away by all sorts of people who may not have the context or the right, correct understanding to perhaps digest those in the way they're supposed to be digested. And I think that's also caused a lot of interesting political situations with designers and with the things that they've decided to show and at certain times why they decide to do that. It becomes questioned in the media as well. Why is a designer showing this kind of thing at this kind of time? And, I mean, there was, of course, there's been a couple of quite strange scandals. Like, I mean, of course, Galliano had his own fair share in his time. And what is put on the catwalk can have a much wider sort of social meaning to it. And I think we'll probably go for a break now and come back to that idea in the second half with a couple of different objects that we've all brought along with us and talk a little bit more about those meanings behind the clothes.
I just wanted to say something. Interesting enough about John Galliano, if you Google John Galliano, the words that come up as suggestions are not John Galliano, fashion designer, it's John Galliano, racist. And so that's, you know, the pervasive media which continues and will continue forevermore.
There you go. So we'll have a bit of a break now and see you back in half an hour. Welcome back.
Thank you.
We're just waiting for speaker number 7 before we restart. And he has a special story to tell of the first time he came to Helsinki. So we'll just wait for him to come back. But as you can see, there's a collection of objects in front of us today, and I'm going to invite you all to come down and also to have a little bit of a play and a look around and pass around some of the magazines and that sort of thing. And there's a couple of hats and books as well. Everybody's sort of bought something that's a little bit of their own fashion ideology and something that shows a piece of clothing or a symbol that goes a little bit deeper than just a fashion object. So those we're going to get to in a moment. And Lutz has on the floor there one of the most exciting collections of those, which maybe we could actually start with, if you don't mind. Oh, here he is. Good evening. Speaker number 7. I thought we would start with Helsinki, 1985.
Helsinki, 1985. Stereo. Hi. Yes, so last time I came here was 29 years ago, 1985, and I have to say it was a completely different place than it is now. It looked quite... The older ones of you in the audience will remember. It looked quite sort of grim. It certainly didn't have the opulence and sense of fun that it does now. And certainly none of the fashion shops. Of course, Stockman was there, and I think they sold Gautier and other things, but it was really a very different place. And I came here because I was invited by a company called Micmac, and the daughter of the owner of the company was this girl called Nita Salavara, and... she was one of Vivienne Westwood's favorite models, and I was invited to come here, and Vivienne did a show here, and I did a show here too, so many years ago.
How do you do a hat show?
How do you do a hat show? Well, I actually... Hi. Well, you might well ask. I designed clothes to go with them, and they were made by Micmac, and I did the hats, and they were a jeans company, so I did... jeans with flare, with trains on. They basically, the front of the leg was like that, and then they had a train on the back, which looked great in drawing, and maybe it's probably good that I'm a milliner, not a fashion designer, because actually to walk in, they were almost impossible because they got caught around each other. So the girls actually just kept falling down the runway. It was more of a performance than anything else, I think. Anyway, it was a good show. And then after that, we did the same show in what was then called Leningrad, of course, St. Petersburg now. This company, Micmac, one of the things that they did is that they had the license with Disney to manufacture Disney-branded T-shirts, etc., for the Russian market. The Russian government supplied their own black market. So we went in this huge truck. We drove from here to Leningrad, and in the back of the truck were, 500,000 T-shirts with Minnie Mouse and Mickey Mouse and Daffy Duck, et cetera, which were then going to be distributed all over Russia. So it was quite an adventure.
And that little adventure that happened between?
Oh, yes. I don't know if it's still like that. But between Finland and Russia, as it then was, there was about 10 or 15 kilometers of no man's land. I mean, it was really quite a large space. I don't know if it's like that now. And on the way back from Russia, it had actually been quite a long trip, and it was an old-fashioned truck, so there wasn't anything like modern conveniences like a toilet or anything in it. So we had to stop in no man's land. They stopped the truck, and everybody jumped off. And very unfortunately, there were about 10 of us, and very unfortunately, they forgot to count me when they got back on and actually drove off. So there was I, fortunately with my clothes on, but without any money or passport or anything like that. And it was, but then they were about 10 minutes down the road before they realized that I wasn't there and had to turn. And I just thought, there's mines everywhere. This was Cold War time. Anyway, I survived.
What
so that's the end of the story.
Did you try and walk anywhere or did you just stay put?
I sort of said my prayers a little bit, but I really did not know what to do, not speaking either Finnish or Russian.
Were you wearing a hat?
Yes, I did have a hat. and it was sort of like a red cowboy hat with a green print on. I can't remember what day it is, but I do remember every single hat.
I love that. Anyway. A hat for protection.
Yeah, well, actually, we got in trouble on the way into Russia because I had a little hole on the top here, and I'd put a microphone in as a joke, which was this joke little Sony microphone, and I just thought it'd be funny. Pinned it in, and in fact, of course, I got into huge trouble and held everybody up. Yeah. Anyway, that's the end of the Helsinki story.
Well, that was a.
And I haven't been back since.
So we're expecting this trip to be a little different, I suppose. A little bit more civilized.
However, Finnish culture and design, and extraordinary. And I'd love to come across a Chanterelle vase somewhere, and any Tapio Wakala. I mean, fantastic. I mean, huge influence on design of hats. That wonderful sweet point between the mechanical and the organic, which was really expressed in post-war Finnish design, is extraordinary and has never been equaled since.
Hear, hear. It's very true. We're going to be very privileged to see some incredible places in the next couple of days, and a couple of the members of the audience have already been lucky enough to go and visit Vorku at her home. Lou was there yesterday morning, and
fabulous.
And
she's
that's
fabulous.
That's one of those incredible characters from your history that has had a really lasting impression on the fashion industry in a much more global sense, and is someone who was a master of mixing those worlds of fashion and design. And she was quite an iconic figure in that late 50s, early 60s freedom of dressing women and loosening the silhouette. So, and she's influenced so many other creators since, and from Japan to Milan to Paris. So some of us are going to go and visit her tomorrow and have a listen to some of her incredible stories. But I'd like to move now on to some of the sort of precious bits and pieces that we've brought along with us to sort of discuss and look at fashion in a way that's a little bit more a little bit more cultural and a little bit more pertaining to the past. And Lutz has brought along some pieces from his own collection that he's designed over the years, and he can explain them perhaps better than I can.
Well, what happened was Dan asked me to bring something that I liked, and then I thought, well, the thing I like most are clothes, and one of my favorite garments is the bomber jacket. And then I thought, okay, I can't just bring this because I wear it anyway, so I need to bring something else. And then I thought, I'll bring some bombers that I've made in the collections, and I just have to explain a little bit of myself before I show those. It's been really interesting for me, this discussion, because I come from, my reason to be in fashion has never been, or it didn't start with wanting to design luxurious things. What happened was I was much more into music than anything else. And I just started to be interested in fashion because I liked what my favorite pop stars were wearing. And then I come from a very small town in Germany. So I grew up in a place where there was not that much culture, and there was nobody dressing differently than anybody else. And you could see how anything that you would wear that would be slightly different would say something about you and would make people react. So my interest in fashion comes from the way that you invent yourself constantly by putting on something every day, and that you can actually be somebody completely different to who you really are, or you can be the person that you think you are just by dressing differently. And I find that extremely interesting, how garments say something about you. And it's interesting, that's the discussion that we had earlier, where we were saying, oh, this doesn't mean anything anymore. But to me, when I started working in fashion, or when I started to decide that I was going to go into fashion, it was so interesting that you could anything that you take, it said something. And any garment that you take that has a history also puts you into perspective. And I've always loved the bomber jacket, the perfecto, the trench coat, because they're pieces that everybody knows. They straight away say something about you. So what happens when you take them and you twist them around, they still say something, but they also say something different. And what I love most in people, or in women, is when I don't understand who or what they are because they dress in a way that I don't understand. Like, I always find it really boring when you can say straight away, okay, this person is very sexy, or this person is I don't know, arty or intellectual or all these things. What I love is when you look at somebody and you can't say what this person is like. So all my collection has always been about this thing of taking things and just pushing them slightly somewhere else so you understand what it is, but it's also something different. And because it's something different, it opens up this space where in a way, it's a space of freedom, because I can't look at you and say anymore, okay, this is what you are. I understand straight away. And it's funny how we do that all the time now. We constantly look at people and straight away think, okay, she's like that, and she is where's that. And I always laugh when I can't do that. Whenever I come across somebody where you can't say that, to me, that's so exciting. And it's so beautiful as well. Anyway, so then I thought, okay, I bring the bomber jackets, and I have through the years designed several ones, and maybe I should show them on somebody. Can I?
Yeah. Do we have some volunteers for this very first?
Can I have four, five girls, please? If you
come on, let's break this experience space,
yes,
and get some people in here. Break the fourth wall.
Get more. Just anybody,
don't make me choose you.
And one thing,
come on, this is what this whole talk is about. It's about reconnecting. Thank you.
So,
thank you. Two more girls.
Okay, so the first, like, this is the original one. The one that I'm wearing is the original one. So that's the one that is, it's the alpha one that everybody wears. And then the first bomber jacket I did, once I had that, I thought, okay, I'm going to do a bomber jacket, and it needs to be more chic, more fashion, more beautiful maybe, but it still needs to have that attitude of being a bomber jacket. And I've always loved when you have a bomber jacket and you put your hands in your pockets and you are like this, because it gives this thing of gesture where you look like you're really strong. Like, you have this thing, you look like you know where you're going, and it gives this strength to anybody who wears it. So this is the first one, which is a mix between a bomber jacket and a smoking jacket. Do you want to put it on? So you still have the bomber jacket, but you also have the smoking, the tuxedo lapel. You have your pockets, and you put your hands in your pockets, and you still have that kind of attitude where you stand like that. And once I did that, I thought, okay, this is too constructed, so I'll have to just make it more fluid, break it down. So this is the next one. Sorry, I feel like I could show myself. Yeah,
do you need an assistant?
No, I'm doing it quickly. So this is, do you want to put this on? This is the fluid. That was the next one, the fluid version, where I just thought I just make it float down. So yeah, so I just make it made it longer, made it asymmetric, and it's this really fluid fabric, and you still have your hands in your pockets, and it still has that movement, but it's slightly more fluid. Then the next one I thought, I've always loved pleats, so for the same reason, because pleats are so everybody knows them, they're very traditional, they're slightly old. And I've always loved that they say something straight away. So I thought, okay, I'm going to take these really old pleats and mix them with the bomber jacket and see what happens. So this was the next one. You need to take off your... Yeah. So... Thanks. Sorry about that. So you have to go in like that.
Lutz, do you give names to your designs?
No, I do it now. I didn't do it at the time. Now we have to for the sales, but I didn't do it at the time. So this is it's like a dress, a cross between a dress and a bomber jacket, and you always have the pockets and the knitwear. Then I thought, okay, I'll have this. So I might as well make a proper dress, and I thought this was the evening dress, so you could just put it on top, but don't worry. Yeah, I think... Okay, so this became the evening version of the bomber jacket. And do you just want to turn around?
Yeah, so let's do a spin.
Can see, sorry. Do you all want to turn around so they can see you? Oh. Yeah, the lineup. Yeah, you can turn around. So this is the way I design in general, where I just go on with something that I do, and I keep changing it constantly from season to season to season to season. And all that we were saying earlier, for me, it's extremely important that things mean something. If it doesn't mean anything to me, or if I don't understand what it is, then it has no meaning at all. And for me, it doesn't make sense at all. And I think I might be fairly alone in that way of designing now, because it's funny, I never think about Instagram moments. I just think about somebody wearing something and me seeing them in the street and thinking, wow, that looks really good. That's the only thing I think about. So I have to adapt to the industry in a way that is...
Please don't.
No, but I have to. I have to survive. No, I have to, seriously. I think it's so important that those things say something about you. And I think whoever sees those four girls, I mean, correct me if I'm wrong, but whoever sees those four girls, I think might at least ask themselves who are those people. And that, to me, is the
most... Could we ask them their names and maybe we could rename these pieces? Yeah. No? What, could you each give us your name? From?
What's your name?
Nora.
Nora.
Ines. Emily from China. Sato, okay.
There we go. Thank
Good.
You.
Thank, well, thank you so much. Thanks.
Yeah, there is a piece behind you. It's true.
Sorry, I forgot about that. It's so small. I forgot about it. Hold on. Yeah,
we
that
have was a really small
version.
Girl.
That was the last version I did, and it took everything away. It was just to cover the shoulder. Do you want to put that on? Yeah, that was the last version. And for me, the perfect way to wear that would have been just with a skirt and nothing else, but nobody wanted to do it. Right, that's the last one. That's the last one.
Keep us.
Do you remember the first bomber jacket you ever saw? Do you remember seeing someone and falling in love with it?
Well, you know what? I mean, in the 80s, people were wearing lots of them, and they had a slightly dangerous connotation at the time. But at the same time, for me, it was obviously interesting because when you would put one on, you'd be slightly dangerous as well. And I have never been dangerous physically and when you grow up in a very small town, looking the way I looked, you could protect yourself wearing a bomber jacket, you know, and looking really. You'd run less of a risk of getting beaten up on the bus. So it's this. There's always this huge power involved, and it's so interesting for me that piece of clothing can say so many things about somebody.
It's a good point to move to perhaps what Stephen's brought along and also the piece he's wearing himself, because it's a very different sort of power to wear a hat, isn't it?
Hats are about power and transformation as well. Most of the time when I'm making a hat for somebody, it's because they want to look like something as opposed to looking like themselves. That's the great thing a hat can do. And that's one of the nice things a hat can do, and can do quite effectively, whereas if you put that into fashion, it looks too much like costume or it doesn't work too much. But I brought along, what hat am I wearing today? Oh, this one. This was just for colour, and, you know, that's it. And it's a bit disco as well, and it works under the lights.
Certainly does.
Bit disco and works under the lights. Et voila. The hats that I brought along, just a couple of little headbands. There's the first one. Hang on. Can you just forget that?
We'll also need some hat models.
I think the two girls here will be good. Funny enough, we were talking about, you know, modern and electronics and all those things, and how they apply to hat making. Well, I mean, hat making is probably the most low-tech of things that you can do, and it's very manual, and sometimes people say, well, do you design on a computer? No, I don't, but I communicate on the computer all the time. I mean, I work around the world, so sometimes we have fittings with Marc Jacobs, and we do that via Skype or FaceTime, and what will happen is that I'll do a sketch, or I'll be fitting an actual hat. They'll do screen grabs, then his assistant will print it out, and then he will draw on a new silhouette or a slightly adapted silhouette, and then he'll show it to me, and he'll say a little bit like this, a little bit. And that's how we communicate and using all those things. And all the time, I mean, I do travel almost every day of the year, and I have a sketchbook with me, and I just take a photograph of my sketch on my phone and send it back to my workroom. That's just how I work. But I don't actually design on the computer. But this was a little bit. This hat was. Hang on. I just need to turn it on. It's a little leather Alice band. Let's see if it's going to work. Yes, it is. And as you can see, it's got a little hat on it. And you can program onto it whatever hat you want, and you can go to my website and download new hats every season. So I'm just going to put this on Lou. And, you know, what else do you need? It changes with the season. We only do black and white. We don't do colour, because if you had to have colour, it would need more batteries, et cetera, et cetera. And you see it's morphing now from a little bowler to a top hat.
And I feel completely different.
Yeah, yeah. So that's sort of technology in a hat, but, you know, it's got 5 hours of mounting this on leather as well, and it's all done by hand because it's such a 3D object. It can't be done by machine. The other little hat I have here was from a collection which was based, it was called Art School, and hats are so thematic. They always tell a story, and I went to Berlin and visited the Bauhaus, or the Bauhaus Foundation, and I just became involved in that world. And I thought, well, am I going to do a collection based on the Bauhaus? And I thought, well, no, because what's interesting, and for all of us, is when we make some sort of design very personal. You know, you can get Bauhaus things in a way from anywhere. What is interesting is how I sort of bring that into my own life. So the collection was based in sort of a weird parallels between the Bauhaus and my time at St. Martin's. And we actually did a series of about 20 hats, and literally the first hat was based on my interview. The second hat was based on me getting the letter to say that I got in. The third hat was based on my first day at college. And this was sort of to do with research. And this was the symbols of the Bauhaus. You might already know this, that the blue was the symbol of the sphere in the world, the red was the earth and was the cube, and yellow was air, ideas, and also corresponded to the shapes as well. So, Francis, if you put this one on, because you are art school. And very nice with hair down. What we do is so much about technique. And for example, this particular little hat here, this is all made from soldered steel wire. And in fact, it's not made in my workroom. It's made by, part of it's made by this guy called Monsieur Carrel in Paris. He works for the opera in Paris. And he's about 80 years old. And all of this, I mean, I sit with him like this, and he's there busy soldering because I can't solder. And all of this is done by eye. He doesn't measure anything at all. So this is just also an extraordinary experience for me to see those craftsmen working and actually bring that back, Michelle, to you, what you were saying about going into Chanel and seeing the ladies in the atelier and how they do. Now, they will show those things. This is the backstage version of things, too. So, anyway, there's a couple of hats that I brought along.
And actually, it reminded me of when we did the magazine, and we were going through all of your archives of the back and forward that you have with all of these designers and the faxes and the sort of early days. I could maybe...
Yeah, I mean, when I pick it up. First started working off in 1400, in 1400, I'd started to make hats for Comme des Garçons, for example. And working with Rei Kawakubo in those days, if I did a sketch in Britain, it would take 5 days for it to get to Tokyo, because this was prefax. And, of course, if you do a sketch, that's a dutiable object. It's actually not a document, so it would have to go through customs. So you can imagine working at that speed in fashion, in the way that we used to work. And now we work in a very fast way. Funnily enough, later on in that series are a whole series of documents which are communication between Rei Kawakubo and myself. And there's some sketches here, things from Thierry Mugler, things from Jean-Paul Gaultier. Oh, this is a communication from Marc Jacobs, the one on the right. And this is where we were doing some fur hats and he wanted to have a bigger silhouette. You can come and have a look at this afterwards. But, you know, in a funny way, what hats, maybe it's because I'm a Gemini, but hats are about communication. They're about speaking another language to each other, you know, a language of style.
And there's the hat that is in the exhibition that you've been travelling right around with the perfume, isn't it?
Yeah. I've just done a second fragrance with Comme des Garçons. I work a lot with them. And these are Ray's notes. This is the first time that anything's been published in her handwriting, by the way. Did you know this?
I did.
I think she's saying, not like that, like this. It's funny, working with dress design, every single designer is different too. You know, working with Rei, I will get a brief. Sometimes the brief will be pink or black or feminine, or I'd like to have a matador hat, or, you know, it can be very specific. And sometimes it will be, there is no brief. And what she will want is, she won't give me a brief at all, and that will be the spice to the collection, to enliven the collection or bring something very specific to it. When I worked with John Galliano, that was a very close collaboration, and we spent days and days and days with each other. I remember once asking him, sorry, we're really getting off topic now. But I remember once saying to him, John, why do you like hats so much? And he said, that's a bit of a crazy question coming from you. And he said, well, of course I do. He said, well, why would I be interested in just stopping at somebody's neck? That's above the neckline of the dress. That's where it becomes really interesting. So that's why he always had such a vested interest in hats. Working with Mark, it's, you know, working electronically. And, you know, for example, I also I worked with Lorraine Scott for many years, too. I knew her since she was a model. And we carried on working when she was a stylist working for Vanity Fair. And we had a great relationship as well. And she was so much about understanding what the woman wanted to have. And, you know, little tricks like, I'm sure this is allowed to be known, but, for example, on Nicole Kidman, padding above her waist on the side of the dresses a little bit to give it a bit more illusion of a waist, to sculpt that waist a little bit more. All these very tiny sort of tricks from like the 50s of Balenciaga and Dior and Balmain, that world, that she brought to contemporary clothing.
Because she worked with a lot of amazing photographers as well, didn't she?
Yeah, so she knew what was going to be, you know, camera ready. And that's why those ladies loved wearing her clothes, because they felt super confident in them.
It's interesting to think about those things that can be taken perhaps at face value in a much less deep side of fashion, but in fact behind them is a lot of craft.
Oh yeah, yeah. I mean, fashion exists on so many different levels. You know, it can be, you know, based on an art concept or something, based on a specific piece of clothing, based on what a girl loves to wear and what she feels fantastic in. I mean, I think one of the great, if you have to say what's the difference to when I first started my career is to now, you know, fashion is much more democratic. You know, fashion certainly, I mean, I didn't start in the 60s, but then it was, okay, Balenciaga's doing this hem length, or Courrèges doing that type of white cotton piqué, and that was it. Now, fashion can be so expressive for so many different sorts of people, and that's one of the things, for example, that Vivian Westwood first did, and she was one of the first people to really try and show that point of view within her clothing and make clothing political.
She is a very important figure in that sort of, in that part of this topic, isn't she? And is one that has had a huge influence on many of the other young British designers, and certainly elsewhere too.
Yeah, I mean, without her, there's no John Galliano, and without her, there's no Lee McQueen either.
And she's one who has as well really backed up her point of view with a huge ethical campaign, which makes it very true and makes it very much related to who she is and how strongly she feels about what she does.
I mean, her campaigns are, I mean, she considers them to be more important than her clothing nowadays. And her clothing is just a vehicle for her occasional rants.
Well, I feel like she's always been that way, even, you know, if you think when her and Malcolm McLaren were doing all the teddy boy stuff, and then they moved away from it because they didn't think that the teddy boys were kind of moral people. They thought that they were ignorant and racist. I love that about her, that the clothes, they always had to be sort of a part of a bigger moral or sort of social issue.
That's the funny thing, they are. I mean, if she did, I mean, she said it, but they are in general. Nobody can deny that in a way. And we forget about it now because it's all so fast. But they are, they have that importance. That's why I also loved the essay, because it is really a matter of life and death. No, it's all that we are about. So she's amazing in that respect, because she's one of the few now who actually says those things. Because we forget, because nobody talks about it anymore.
I was talking to someone about this, and I think that part of the reason that people often say that fashion's less political now, but I wonder if it's because of all the social media stuff that we were talking about before. Designers are scared to make a political statement in any way, because everything is released so fast and written about so fast. I think everyone's very scared of being misinterpreted, so people don't do things anymore that are controversial, because before people could ponder them, whereas now taken very much at face value very quickly, and it's hard to go back on anything.
Well, hopefully there's a whole new generation of designers who are going to come up and tell us old farts that we need to get political again.
Yes, but also they had nothing to lose at that time. You know, like Vivienne Westwood and Malcolm McLaren were doing all the, I mean, what I call punk, you know, from seditionaries and everything. They were they were part of the punk movement themselves. I mean, they were like part of the scene. They were almost like musicians, and what they did also had like, of course, a social value, and maybe that comes to say that's something that may be missing in our era. It's like, you know, I said that the two biggest movements, maybe three, were the hippies, you know, the punks, and maybe the grunge movement in the early 90s, because it brought much more than music. It was like a very big thing that came, you know, was a way of living and all that kind of things. And so far, I think for the past like 20 years, there's been nothing like this. You know, it's very subversive, very subculture, but there's nothing majorly that, you know, a lot of people want to follow.
And there's so much cross-referencing, isn't there?
It's yes, but like the punk thing is like, I mean, you still see a lot of people who wear punk haircuts, like, you know, even when you go to the bank, you know, sometimes, like, I see, like, a woman, she's got, like, half of hair, like, almost shaven, but she doesn't know she's punk, you know, it has this extent of things, you know, and it's an aesthetic that a lot of, and I think we're missing something like that.
I mean, the only thing is that there are, I think there's other sorts of political expression. I think about, you know, the Fashion Revolution Day. So, you know, to time in, obviously, with the Rana Plaza disaster. So the 24th of April, everybody was encouraged to wear their clothes inside out to make the point about where were your clothes, where did they come from. And that was something that was going on in a number of different countries. And certainly we had some of our students marching down Oxford Street with their clothes inside out.
Just to elaborate for everyone, that this was the disaster in Bangladesh.
It was a disaster in Bangladesh, obviously, where so many people got killed. So, and I think, so that's quite interesting. So again, it's using the clothes to say something else, and something quite fundamental about something that I think everybody needs to be encouraged to do, to think about where your clothes have come from and how they've been made. So I think there is a slightly, you know, it's not quite like the sort of Catherine Hamnett big T-shirt. I mean, obviously, you still get bits of that, but in a way, it's much more of a campaign where people can actually come together to make a statement, which I think is really good.
In France last week, actually, in certain high schools, I think it was in Lyon, could be corrected if I'm wrong, all the boys came to school wearing skirts in a gender equality campaign.
Yeah.
And it actually completely hit the news all over France and elsewhere.
And it was in London, yeah.
For a positive message like that. I guess it's a good moment to mention France's new book, which is...
I should do it with the hat.
I think they're on for the rest of the talk.
I feel as though I should keep it on.
Why Fashion Matters, which you released, I believe it's about 2 weeks ago now, right?
Yeah, it is, yes. So
it ends very well with your hat.
It does, doesn't it? And in a way, I mean, the reason I sort of wrote it, I was asked to write it because I've been writing for a while about, you know, particularly some of these political issues. And I've been at the head of college for nearly 10 years now, and certainly things have changed a lot. I mean, when I first was appointed, there was a whole sense a bit, you know, because I don't come from fashion. I actually went to St. Martin's and then Chelsea. So I come from a fine art background and then did a doctorate at Oxford in education. So I've got quite a broad experience and hadn't been responsible for fashion before, but had become very interested in how, as a subject, it connected to so many different things and actually said so much about us, obviously, as individuals, but was so important, you know, in terms of society, culturally, economically. And so for me, getting the job was really important. But, you know, 10 years ago, fashion, particularly in the sort of press in the UK, it was responsible for anorexia, all the sort of woes of the world. Any time that it was sort of represented, you probably have somebody wearing something really extraordinary. It was something to be laughed at. And also very often seen to be something that was, it's for girls, it's for women, you know, it's not really that important. And yet, obviously, as we know, it employs so many people around the world. As I was saying earlier, it's so important as an economic driver and so on. So I sort of felt that it was really important to, in a way, try and make that point, and had been writing about that and was approached to sort of do it. And so the book is, in a way, 101 thoughts. It's got no pictures. People say, why hasn't it got any pictures? Well, actually, you know, in a way, it doesn't need pictures because everybody knows that, what fashion is about. But what I wanted to do was to try and get people to actually think what it means to them, and why we buy in the way that we do, why things are made in the way that they are. You know, why things can transform. So you put a hat on and suddenly, you know, you are transformed. Your bomber jacket says something else about you. And to try and sort of encourage that. And particularly, really, for me, if I was to say what was the most important thing, was is a bit like if you think, well, you know, the clothes you wear, the food you eat and the shelter you have, those are the fundamental things that we need as human beings. And that we ought to take far more care. There's been a big organic movement. People worry about what they eat. You had things like the horse meat scandal in the UK about food production. Why don't people care about how their clothes have been made? Why is it acceptable to buy something cheap that somebody else hasn't been paid a living wage for? You know, why is that okay? And so hopefully, what I was trying to do was to, you know, through the fact that fashion is an extraordinary thing, it is so fundamental to us, actually get people to think, I ought to care. I ought to perhaps take more care about why I buy in the way that I do, to say something about myself. And those are the sorts of thoughts. So it's got quotes in, questions. Nothing's more than 800 words. So for all of us who suffer from attention deficit disorder, it's quite easy. You can sort of carry it around with you and just sort of read bits and pieces here and there.
So if anyone would like to come and have a look at the book, this is probably I'm going to invite everybody to come down and have a look at everything. But I wanted to just touch on a point that you mentioned about that perspective of fashion and how that has changed and it has been given a bit of a more positive light and how museums, etc. The credibility of fashion has increased enormously.
It has, yeah.
I wanted to pose to Ryan the question about, you know, coming from a bit more of an art dealer background and dealing with galleries, exhibitions and that sort of thing and then shifting across, what do you think of the perspective of fashion in a wider creative sense? Do you and in terms of the different cities that you've experienced that?
Well, coming from Northern California or California in general, but Northern California specific, you know, it kind of has more of a, you know, social history being more hippie or radical fringe, a little more natchy, you know, a little more about outerwear and less, you know, and then coming to Paris where it's elevated to an aesthetic that's very different. You know, even the average person on the street is very pulled together and looking quite chic. It's very opposite. Or then going to school in Boston, say across the country, you know, where that has its own set of codes, you know, and very collegiate and that kind of those armors that people are wearing and those uniforms say something very different, you know, East Coast to West Coast, you know. You know, I've been very, very different, you know. And even what you're saying, maybe in the contemporary art world, you go walk into a contemporary art opening and it can look very arty. Someone like Cindy Sherman does whole studies on what, you know, these arty women look like, you know. It's, you know, there's all these signifiers and codes and armors and uniforms that we're wearing on the daily, depending on who we think we are, as we've been talking about, or what we want to express. And, you know, that can extrapolate that into every scene, music, whatever, you know, and then the people that subvert those codes within those, you know, if you can move within a chameleon within a scene and, you know, someone might not know what you're about at all based on what you're dressing like, but then you wear one small little thing that says something different. You know, I might look like I'm dressed a little conservative or something from something else, but then I have something that's like from Throbbing Gristle and industrial music, and that's going to kind of like change the conversation, you know, and how I'm going to kind of connect with somebody, what I really care about, what I'm putting out to somebody or to the world, and what kind of conversations I want to have based on what I'm wearing or saying. You know, I don't have to have the band T-shirt exactly, but what I might be wearing in a small pin or, you know, a small little accessory is saying a lot more about my philosophy on life and music and where I'm coming from than, you know, the look, you know, in general. So I guess there's a mix depending on what your occupation or interest or how you're moving in the world, what all those things are. But hopscotching around as I had the last couple of months, there's been a rotation of looks and scenes and all of that. It's all quite different. And then being here, it's different again. You know, in Helsinki, you know, it's the overall landscape of look and dress codes are changing once again. You know, haircuts even and all of that. So,
what do you think about that idea of those kind of arty women and that sort of very high elevated art scene and the fact that fashion today is now so almost integrated into those worlds, and that now you can see Cindy Sherman turning up at an event like dressed by a brand, for example, or like wearing a Marc Jacobs dress or something like this. Do you think that there is, like, the borders are hugely broken down now, or is there still kind of a snobism of the art world against fashion?
It depends. I mean, I think it can be like some, if you want to say elevated, but something very avant-garde, like, you know, the newest collection, you know, such and such designer, where it's very forward and it's kind of like a new aesthetic, or it's the pushing of boundaries of aesthetics. So we're kind of growing as a society, and it's, you know, that's why it's pushing things. But then also you can go very street, and you can be on a music scene that's super underground, and you'll see kids in street fashion. You're like, oh my God, that look is amazing. How did they do that? Or it's, and then those looks will be co-opted by designers as their own or something new, but it's actually seen on the street first, you know? So it depends. I mean, it can, whether you're in high art or it's high low, it's all, it depends. I mean, some kids that have no, that don't care about, you know, labels, you know, have a more avant expression than anything that you would see on the catwalk that's brand new, you know? So, and those designers look to those kids sometimes, you know, to the street. That's been how it's been for a long time,
for
sure, to some degree. But, you know, downtown New York City or San Francisco, kids that are into vintage, you'll just see things that just blow your mind. In the toughest of neighborhoods in San Francisco, you go to walk in the Tenderloin, you'll see, you know, people living in SROs that are working looks, and it just blows your mind. You can't believe what they're putting together with just the thrift, you know, and that whole subculture of amazing.
Well, I think
California,
you can look at
thrift.
Fashion students as well across the world.
Exactly.
And how they dress.
Exactly, exactly. Or art school, or how contemporary art, something like Sterling Ruby has been now working with Ralph Simmons on a collection, how those worlds are kind of coming together, and art as art, wearing art, you know, and how that is what's saying whatever that's saying, and how that can be very, very successful in itself, and depending on the collaboration and that kind of thing. So
whether it's well done or whether it's fumbled about and made into a print on a T-shirt, I suppose.
Exactly.
Yeah. It's what you were saying about the street is interesting. I recently read an article, just a sort of a diary entry by APC's founder, Jean Toitou, and he was saying how the street doesn't actually inspire him anymore, and he's bored by what he sees on the street because people are too concerned by these cultural signifiers and these symbol items and the pricey handbag and the specific designer jeans, and how actually he went to Istanbul and he saw, like, one of these kids skating, and he had one of his traditional shirts, fringes, like, sort of flapping out from underneath a T-shirt, and how that, like, completely blew his mind compared to walking down the coolest suburb in the coolest city and seeing everybody, in a way, dressed the same.
I know, because the coolest people in the coolest city is always also wearing APC, so that's why he's not concerned about it. You know? Because it's part of that cool factor, you know.
Yeah, I guess it's a.
It's true. I mean, it's like the Celine bag and the whole thing. Like, all the kids, they wear APC because they think, okay, you know, it's cool, it looks nice. So of course it's not very challenging for him.
It's interesting to see the reaction from.
Of course.
Within.
I think we're all the same. Like, you know, I mean, also like traveling to places you're not used to travel. Like, you know, I mean, even like for me, Turkey is still an exotic, you know, destination. But I went to Mumbai, you know, so like I was walking on the beach and I saw some most amazing looks, like, you know, mixing motorcycle pants and, like, you know, trainers. I mean, like, Adidas jackets and, like, sandals, all that kind of stuff. But they really looked amazing, and their haircuts and everything. And I don't know, like, the style also, like, in Bali and all these places, you know, like, they're very style conscious, but they do it with what they can. And I think they look cooler than a lot of people who try to look cool. But
and that's what people did. I mean, 3-4 decades ago, that was how you did make
yes.
your, I mean, in general, I think it's a perfect way to talk, just to mention your object that you brought as well. I mean, oh, that scene. Sorry?
If you want.
Yeah, no, I mean, well, you can show it, I think, to
okay.
everybody. This is Michelle, one of
okay,
Michelle's
so
pieces.
This is a book called Andy Warhol's Index Book, and it was, I think it was printed in 1970, and it was given to me when I was living in California in 1972. And it meant a lot to me because it's the first time I mean, whether you like Andy Warhol for his art or not, what I like about him is, like, the first social media artist. He's the one who set the parameters, you know, for what we do today. So he was fascinated by making superstars out of people who are not necessarily superstars. I was fascinated by glamorizing the everyday life, like, you know, and also, like, fascinated by archiving and documenting everything he did, like, you know, like taking pictures of everywhere he go, everywhere he went, wrote the diaries, you know, had people with him, like recording things, like he had the first cassette recorders, you know, and recording conversations, was completely obsessed. And like once he said, in the future we'll be famous for 15 minutes, and I think it's like today what we do with Facebook and Instagram and all these kind of things. I mean, we all are famous, you know, we all use this, like, this image of ourselves, and like, whether it's to promote yourself or your lifestyle or things you like, I mean, and so I had this book and I lost, I mean, I destroyed it, so I bought another one in California, and I'll show you some of the, it's a, one of the first books that was like a complete social media. It's got a little interview from Lou Reed on the CD, if I can find it, little pop-up things, you know, and I mean, it meant a lot to me, and it's about also a bit like the person I am in a way, you know, like, I like to touch a bit of everything, so that's it.
Because you today,
can,
I mean,
you can look at it too very carefully, though, please. It's rare. Thank you.
It's a good lead as well into your own sort of exploration of all that sort of culture. I think what's interesting about today is the is this excessive consumption of images. And we made a bit of a conscious decision to not make this a huge digital presentation today. We're not showing you videos and slideshows and all this kind of thing, but just to bring it back to something a little bit more concentrated, because there is so much imagery that is being forced at us every day, every minute, on every single network that we can connect to with every device. And the meaning behind that is quite often lost, and I think there's a nearly close to a whole generation that is used to that and is used to the lack of context that gives images. And when you see something in a book, I was talking to Kim Jones, the designer of Louis Vuitton, about this, and he was talking about the way that he collects objects and how he collects books and things and particular pieces of clothing. And he said to me, the internet is just not a proper archive. It's not, you can't go and find that Helmut Lang collection from 97 and know exactly, you know, from that book. You don't know what's on the next page on the internet. That's the problem. There is no next page. You know, you're in this insane sort of database, and the whole sort of point of layout and order and evolution is completely lost. And as you browse a Tumblr site, and it's filled with, you know, incredible images from now and from the near and distant past, but if they're not put in any sort of context, you can completely lose the meaning behind them. They can be taken for the wrong reasons, all this sort of thing. So, I mean, I think Michelle's own Instagram account is an incredible sort of its own little cultural hub there, where he has nearly 50,000 people following what he's up to, and it, I guess it poses you great things and problems sometimes, right?
Problems a little bit. I mean, One time I took a picture from someone's website, and it was, I don't know, and like the guy got really mad and said, oh, you should be ashamed of taking a picture. I'm going to report you, you know, like, you know. I thought it was very rude because, you know, I don't, it's like I take pictures from people. Sometimes I don't even know where they're coming from. I just like the picture, I just quote it, you know. And then some people do some quotes sometimes that are not so cool, but it's not really what I call trouble, you know.
Yeah. How did you start doing it? How did you get all involved with it?
Well, I do lots of research, whether it's like music, image, or whatever. I'm like, I may be Japanese at one point, you know, like I like to search for things. And I started with Facebook, and someone told me, oh, do Instagram, it's easier. So I started to do Instagram, and I don't know, I'd caught up, like, you know, one day, like, I had like 500 people liking me, and then like 3,000 people, and I got caught in the game, like, you know, because like, sometimes there's pictures I put on it. I know, oh, I know this one's going to hit big. And when it hits big, oh, my God, I was right. You know, so it's like it's some kind of a game. You know what I mean? So it's a hobby, more or less. But I want to get out of it a little bit. I mean, I overdid it. And I think there's going to be other things. I think it's a bit like becoming tired of this social media kind of thing. You know, I mean, it's not becoming tired, but I want to use it for other purposes. You know, I made a point. I had a good time with it. But, like, let's move on.
And I think that's that perfect sort of signifier of that culture of of people that that don't.
Yes. But I must admit, like, you know, when you go on Tumblr, I mean, there's some people who are amazing websites, like very good image collectors. I mean, not necessarily the most, not necessarily about fashion or anything like that, but, you know, there's some guys who put, like, randomly pictures of any kind of things, and they put them together, and it makes so much sense. And this, I think, is quite amazing, because they're, like, really bloggers I respect, because they take me, I don't know how to describe what they do, but, like, there's one called Temple White, again, people can go look at it, another one called Angaro Cinzano. Like, I think they're very good Tumblrs, and they also like the names of the Tumblrs, because it's, I think it's better than rock bands, because rock bands, I mean, there's 10 groups that can be called the Residents. There's no legal issues. But on the internet, if you're called the Residents, like, you cannot create another website called the Residents, so they have to find, like, weirder names, you know? So you have, like, you know, Akil Foray or Raph Foray or, you know, these kind of things, even fashion-wise, you know, like Balenciaga did it first. I mean, all of those things, they're quite funny. So I like all the names of the Tumblr. I think they're very inspiring also.
Does it worry you all? Because I guess, like, you've worked on collections that have been around for sort of like pre-internet, and people perhaps aren't aware. Same with you, Stephen. Does it worry you when you see imagery online and it isn't credited and people aren't saying what the source is? You know, obviously people put up images of old collections and they won't get the season right. Do you think it's fine that people just take it at that visual level, where that something speaks to them and they want to post it?
Both. I mean, this is one thing I like today, is like the lack of culture and interest sometimes, you know, because, like, a lot of people, they look at something and just look at the face of it, and they don't worry about what's behind it or why it is like this. So I think it's like, it's the same for anything, same for music, the same for, oh, I like this, oh, I don't like that, and period. Like, so I think that anything is worth, like, some analysis or like some understanding. And then if that person I see on the website, like, they have a good sense of images, if they put that image in, I say, okay, that's cool. You know what I mean? It all depends on the context.
I think it's the visual currency that we have now is really expanded. When I first started off, you know, this was, of course, pre-internet and everything. And if you wanted to find a particular photograph, you had to go to a library or a bookshop and find it. It was a huge amount of effort. So therefore, you appreciated it more in a way, but as well, you didn't know. If we take, for example, the current exhibit at the Met in New York, which is the Charles James exhibition, if you look at the photograph, which is the Cecil Beaton photograph on the cover of the book, and which has been used for the publicity pictures, which is about 10 girls all in a fabulous panorama, all wearing pastel colored gowns. I mean, I remember seeing that in a book in about 1976, but it was published nowhere. And the only way I could actually go and see it properly, and I then find out it was in color, is I had to make an appointment to go to Sotheby's to see it, because it was not published, and they held his archive. So I think, yes, in Instagram, of course, nothing is credited, but it had really expanded people's visual range of what images can be. However, not everybody's so happy with that. I remember putting up a picture of a particular editorial, and I got hate mail from the hairdresser who did the hair to go with on the editorial, saying, well, what about all of our credits? You know, you're really behaving badly. So, you know.
Well, I had one. I go back to a bad criticism, because in February I put a picture of a model. Her name is Maria Carla, and she's a very beautiful girl. And it was a picture of her, like, you know, when she was 18 at school. And, like, she said, take it off. So I didn't know it was meant to me, you know. And so 2 hours later, would you take it off? I mean, otherwise I don't talk to you anymore. You know, and she was talking about, and I said, oh, when? I don't look sexy. I thought it was, but she went on and on and on and on, and then she thanked me, you know. But that's the most trouble I got.
I have a similar thing, actually, because I put Naomi's first ever fashion editorial was for Elle magazine, Naomi Campbell, and she was wearing one of my hats, and it was edited by Lucinda Chambers, who's now on Vogue. And she wasn't particularly happy that I put a picture of her at age 16 on it, because, you know, there's now, which she still looks fabulous, but then, of course, she was looked like a 16-year-old. People don't want to be reminded.
Did you receive a BlackBerry?
That's wearing my hat so you can't see the dent.
Next hat inspiration.
Yeah, you should do a BlackBerry. Yeah, yes.
That's a great idea, Lou. Yeah. Thank you, team.
Wow. Model behavior, that could be.
Yeah. Yeah.
I think all of this is a really interesting example of the fact that there is so little boundaries and so little rules in this new digital system that we're all sort of existing in, and the fact that, you know, people can get upset because there's no credits, or people can be, you know, leaking the news, or they can be doing all of these things, and the misinterpretation. And what you said about that increased visual library is also almost sort of against the whole idea of the exclusivity, I suppose, again, and keeping that mystery. Do you think it's always a good thing?
I think it is. It's just the way things are going. I think there's nothing that we can't stop it. It is fashion and how we consume media now. The great alternative to all of this modernization, digitalization, is the sort of finely crafted art object. And, you know, we talk about luxury, and we were talking about luxury beforehand, and what is luxury? Well, I think there are some people who want to have a $300 Michael Kors handbag, but at the same time, people who really buy fashion are looking for something handmade. Mm. And there is a real sort of feeling of downsizing people, things having made to measure by small suppliers or small creators. And in fact, all the fashion houses are getting onto the same thing. You know, Vuitton, they have a special department now for handmade, very beautiful things. Of course, by their nature, they're expensive, but it's the fact that they're handmade is more important than they're a luxury object.
Can I also make another sort of related comment, which is the issue about curation? Because I think that one of the reasons that people now, I mean, it's a word that's bandied around so much, but I think it's about giving people the opportunity to have some sort of guide through, because there is so much imagery, because there are so many. So the fact that you've got somebody who can help you by, whether it's through Tumblr or whatever it might be, or whether it's through an exhibition or whatever, that it just makes all the difference, because people need that help. And I think, for academic institutions, it's also one of the things that we have to think about quite a lot, because when there is so much information out there, in a way, why would you come to study? Because you can download, you know, patterns, how to make a shoe, anything can be downloaded from the internet. So coming here to study is, again, another way of actually developing your rigor. As you say, the context, the meaning by which somebody's pulled together a collection of images is the thing that's really important. And that's the sort of thing that we, I think, have to be really pushing very hard to, I think, not only with our students, but also to get for, because that's what other people are looking for. They want to find a route through, a map through all of this stuff.
Mm. Have you noticed more and more, especially with the tuition fees that everyone talks about so much in the UK at the moment, the rise to 9,000 a year, have you noticed that even more, that students, they don't think about coming to college actually to learn something, they just kind of almost feel like they're buying something on their CV that's going to get them a career?
It's a difficult one. I mean, I agree. And I think it's not just because of the fees, but it's also to do with the culture, which is so much about, you know, buying and the service culture that we have. Yeah. And I think one of the big challenges is that students will say, well, you know, I've paid this much, I therefore expect, you know, what do I need to get an A? You know, I've worked very hard, why haven't I? You know, it's the idea that if I'm putting in all the hours, therefore I'm going to be talented, you know, and I've paid for it as well. Mm-hmm. So that's one of, and I think for creative institutions, you know, I think, as we all know, the whole point is that you take risk, that you push things further than they could possibly go, because that way, you know, you can rethink what a bomber jacket is, because you're prepared to actually totally reconceptualize. You're not working within the constraints of it. You're actually seeing how you can push it even further.
Also, it's personal.
And that's difficult. And it's personal.
That's the thing. It's personal. It has something to do with yourself. You work with yourself. And what happens often now is that people just work with what's around them. About themselves. Or it's about themselves, but in a bigger picture. It's not about their personal experiences. It's just what everybody else experiences and what they are in relationship to that.
I think that it's really important, because I think the other thing that's very challenging when there is so much available at the click of a button, that the idea that you can have information just sort of downloaded into your brain, that you don't have to make any effort to take the chance to, you know, connect yourself properly. And it's through that that you are able to then redesign, rethink, you know, do the sort of work that Stephen does with hats or with music or whatever it is, because you're actually, investing yourself in it. It's not something that you can buy. You have to, you know, you come to study and to take chances, not to have it just sort of poured into your brain or downloaded into your brain.
You don't buy talent anyway.
You don't. You can't buy it.
You're talented or you're not. I mean, exactly. But you're a good maker or you're not. I mean, it's not, talent is not because you're better than the other person, but some people are talented and some people are just good makers, you know. And you just have to accept what you are, basically, you know, so.
And also what you're saying about the amount of information that's out there now. That's why editors and stylists are so kind of exalted and important. Mm-hmm. It's about the curation of all that information, looking at the internet. It's not hard to find the info. It's kind of like putting your mouth up to a fire hydrant and turning it on. It's like you can take it full blast, but how are you going to sift through it and make sense of it and curate something that's going to like make a narrative, kind of like Michelle does with his Instagram. You know, it's to watch Michelle kind of go through images. I sometimes joke with him, it's a little bit like the end of Clockwork Orange where the images are going and he's like, bingo, you know, and all of a sudden it's like there, down, you know. It's the editing, you know, the editors are so important, the stylists are very important in how they're going to make sense of all the info that we're given on the daily, not even on the daily that's being produced, but what's the past, you know, looking through as much the music as we do, not only the past, but right now, the amount of records that are coming on the daily, you know, self-published, DIY, not only on the internet or blogs that aren't even published material, so it's a lot of info, you know.
Because that's the most important thing, I think, to be able to make sense of what's happening. Because I find myself looking through so many images that everything just becomes the same. So I'm unable to make any decision, and in the end, I do nothing. Like, I go for hours through stuff, and it's all so much. I like the first and the second and the 10th image and the 20th image, but by the 400th one, I'm just so full. And in the end, I find myself not using anything. And I think that's the most difficult thing with the internet. And I love the internet, but you get to a point where it's so much information, in the end, you use nothing. Because it's all...
I'm sorry.
Sorry.
No, it's the same for music. I mean, that's why in music there's been like compilations for the past 15 years that are very successful, because, you know, like, music is also very easy to get lost in. I mean, even more than images, I think. If you're not into music, it's very hard. And that's why, I mean, personally, I started doing CDs for Colette in 2001. And they were quite successful because we were like, when you go to a big store like that, or anyone who knows music a little bit, you're completely lost. But if there's someone whose taste you like or that you trust, oh, this one made a new compilation. Okay, I'll get it because I know it's good. Or if there's a magazine you like, you know, Ryan Reads The Wire, like, you know, if you get a compilation from them, it's going to be nicely selected and all that kind of stuff. So you need these kind of people. And I think it's for a lot of things you need. That's why I like also some bloggers that I mentioned earlier, because they're kind of curators, you know, like, and it's going to be more and more like this because, you know, it's like what Ryan said also with stylists, you know, like such stylist is a good, like, it's got a good eye, you know, and it's just, okay, if that one says it's nice, then, you know, it's nice, you know. And
at the end of the day, they're all curatorial projects. Yeah. The DJ that you follow, the stylist that you follow, the photographer that you follow.
It's worrying in some ways, though, because it feels like people, like, it goes back to what we're saying about people being individuals or people being in tribes, because there's so much and there's too much information that people, as you said, they just want to be told what to like now, because, and you can't really blame them because there's too much to have to look through. So they just want, a blogger to say wear this or you to say listen to this, and rather than having to kind of like chat to their friends and just,
well,
because it's too much.
I know, but that's, you know, given our life today, I mean, if you have to take care of everything you want, like there's so much you have to do between like traveling, you know, like, if you want to eat, if you want to do this, if you want to go to a museum, if you want to go to the movies. I mean, you know, some movies, I mean, I read what they're about before. Like, you know, I like to have people's advice. Otherwise, there's too much stuff to do. You know what I mean? So according to your taste and what you like, you know what to dig. You know what I mean? And find these kind of things. But there's too much compared to when I was a kid. I mean, like, you know, I was bored when I was 10, but now I'm not bored at all. I mean, there's so much stuff to enjoy. You know, so it's true. I mean, like, you know, I'm not a spring chicken, so... When I was younger, it was like more difficult. We only had two TV stations in France when I grew up. You know, now we have 5,000.
What do we think about the the sort of backlash against the freedom of information, I've noticed, well, there's an absolute growing trend towards actually protecting images and the control of what gets out there. And things like American Vogue have this Vogue archive that costs like an inaccessible amount of money for a normal person to go and pay for, but brands will spend, you know, a few thousand dollars a year to have access to all of their archives. And likewise with certain news that we would once expect to be able to go to the New York Times website as much as we want, but now you have, I think it's 10 articles a month and that's it, then you have to subscribe.
But even designers saying you can't social media at their shows, it's a similar thing, like you're not allowed access.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I think that itself is an interesting backlash and a control mechanism, which is possibly quite a good thing in some ways, if it's well balanced.
It is a good thing.
Yeah.
Anyway, I think we all need to be educated more than
exactly
than we are, because like all of this is new and like people take everything for granted. We all get like whatever we need, and I don't think it's fair in a way, you know. So because it's not, I don't think we're able to process all of this, mm-hmm. and there's like a, how do you say?
It makes things less special.
You have to be aware of what you do. It's like in the beginning of cell phones, like, you know, people would be calling like all over the place. You'd go on the train, like 20 people would be, can you buy a chicken for me tonight? Or, you know, can you change it? And now people don't do that anymore. They're aware and they're on the phone, so they go like discreetly, you know. And I think for social media, it's the same thing. You know, you have to teach yourself some kind of courtesy, some policy, things you do, things you don't do. And it's too new. It's like, maybe I'm getting carried away there, but like, you know, it's also when you go to a fashion show and like now you see no Instagram, no Facebook, no social media. I approve of this because, you know, like most people, they go, they're sitting front row and they have their telephone and just like, they're not even watching the show. They're just like, you know, and they post it, look what I'm saying, you know, why don't you enjoy what you're doing? You know what I mean? It's like, so that's in that way, I think we need to be more educated and
a bit of a return to experience as well.
Exactly, because otherwise you're bored. Because, like, you know, I'm going to a fashion show, I'm going to post it. And, like, is that all you get from the fashion show? Just enjoy the experience.
It could be
the same thing for movies or parties
but
or whatever.
In concerts, they just hold up their things. Yeah. It's so funny that ocean of telephones filming instead of them dancing or getting drunk, it's they're filming. I find that so weird, you know? Yeah.
Just watch it and dance do whatever,
exactly.
You know, but just
exactly. But you film to be able to say, okay, I was there.
But it's that thing, you know, there's that saying where it's like, oh, if a tree falls in the forest and no one hears it, does it really fall? It's like, if you went to a concert but you didn't Instagram it, did it really happen?
Yeah, I know. Yeah, but that's part of being educated, you know what I mean? It's like, it's part of, like, I think this is going to wear down all these kind of things in a way. I think it's going to do.
I have also my last object to show, which will possibly lead into the last part of the talk, which I want to talk a little bit more about signifying garments and things that are special to each of us, a bit like Lutz's bomber jacket. I've brought along this strange limp object on the table here, which is a face mask.
Who's going to model it for you?
I'm not going to model it myself because I can't talk then. But this is it's a hospital face. Should I put it on?
Hold the microphone for you? I hold your microphone. So here you go. You see Mr. Tholey putting his mask on?
I'll show you the inside first. It's it's from the Maison Marta Margiela. From spring, summer 1989. So it was shown in 1988.
You look fabulous.
Thank you, Michelle. and I brought this along because for me, it's something that I found in Antwerp, where Martin is from. And it's something that signifies his very earliest collections, and it's a piece that for me has a huge significance in speaking about fashion going beyond wanting to just dress people and wanting to and it actually makes quite a guerrilla statement, being between looking like somebody looking like a terrorist or looking like someone who is working in a hospital or a dentist and about to feed you laughing gas, and it has quite a subversive sort of element to it, and
It's going to be on a social network within.
And it's going to. And here I am speaking.
Instagram.
So I mean, yeah, I mean, to wear this is not like a necessarily a viable idea to walk down the street wearing this, but for me, it's like a special object that says the fashion show and a performance is much more than just what's going to be on the rack in the show and so voila. So
also, I think it's funny what people want to buy a designer version of and what they don't. You know, like if you think about the huge number of people in the world who do wear paper masks across their face when they're in the street. But you think, you know, why is it so normal to want a designer bag or a designer coat?
But all the Japanese people aren't wearing Louis Vuitton face masks.
Why not a Louis Vuitton face mask? You know, it's what Stephen said, well, you can just get a Tesco bag to put your stuff in. Why do you have a designer one? But why are you happy with a paper face mask? I feel like there's so many interesting
things.
It's
the seductive nature of fashion in the end and the utility that needs to kind of go ahead with it. And this isn't very
it's a big reveal.
I think unless anyone else has another point to bring up, I could finish it here with a bit of question time and the final quote. But I guess is everyone good to do that? Yeah, we're good. Okay, cool. Whoever would like to come up to ask a question actually has to come up to ask a question. So please feel free.
I just sent that picture to here to send it on to Marta as well.
Fantastic. Okay, so that's going straight to Mr. Margiela, apparently. This one's got a few connections, obviously. does anyone have a question? We can just pass the microphone around as well. I mean, you don't be shy. Do you have one over here? Do we have a spare?
Hi. This is a bit of an abstract question, and referring to the first part of the talk. But I was thinking, since you were talking about how in the past fashion used to be for a certain elite and like a very specific thing, and then now it's like being like overly consumed. So, and in that sense, being like mainstream instead of specific. So do you think that in a sense fashion can go out of fashion, or is it by definition always in fashion?
Who'd like to start?
I think that's a great point. If earlier I talked about somebody buying a Montana outfit from top to toe and not being able to buy the shoes. I mean, that's in a way the ultimate expression of fashion, because that's buying the entire look. I think it's moved on very much from that. When I first started, that was the beginning, as they used to call it then, of the designer decade. So we really sort of surfed on the top of that great big fashion movement. And then came a point when people really didn't want fashion. But then what was extraordinary about that is that one designer really interpreted that in a new way and interpreted that people who didn't want fashion, and that was Helmut Lang. And he was created an extraordinary career from that. And grunge as well, you know, if you think that Marc Jacobs. So there is always a fashion version of what is going on. I don't know if that answers part of your question, but you were going to say something.
I just think one thing that's interesting, I do agree there's a fashion for fashion at the moment. You know, even we all talked about the Savage Beauty exhibition and, you know, that the fashion for the fashion exhibition. I was actually going to say a really similar thing to what Stephen said, which is you always get this a fashion then for anti-fashion, but it's still a fashion, if that makes sense. Exactly what Stephen said with, you know, Helmut Lang or even APC that we were talking about. You see a real kind of vogue at the moment for basics or for, you know, you look at the whole minimalism thing and stuff that doesn't have labels on it, you know, that's still a fashion, even if it's an anti-fashion fashion. So it's always that kind of weird circle where.
But fashion has been in fashion for a long time now. So I wonder, I mean, I keep thinking it should go out of fashion, and it would be really good if it did, but I can't see it happening for the time being. It's funny how.
But what will happen if it does?
Well, it'll just make space for something different. Like, I remember distinctly that at the end of the 80s, nobody wanted to wear designer clothes anymore. It was really funny, and it was so fresh. People just wanted to go out and dance and take drugs and wear T-shirts. And it was such an amazing moment, because you felt such relief that you didn't have to buy stuff, that you didn't have to look in a certain way, because the 80s was so much about how you looked. And then suddenly all that was over, and it was such a liberating moment.
The original normcore.
It was incredible. It was such an incredible moment. And I keep waiting for it to come back. I keep thinking this can't go any further now.
It will come back. But you had this before also, like in the 80s, you know, in France, you had like Mugler, Montana, Beretta, all those very architectural, sculptural, glamorized thing. And then arrived Reka Rakubo and Yoji Yamamoto, and it was like a tsunami of like the torn sweaters and all that kind of stuff. I mean, even people were just, oh my God, what is this? I can't believe this is fashion, but like it really took over, you know what I mean? So it's like people are ready for a change. And myself, I believe that the fashion that's going to be out of fashion is what I call the status fashion. You know what I mean? It's like, but fashion will always be in fashion, of course. People would still want new things and create new things. But the fact of wearing something because it comes from such a place, that's like, to me, that's like not in fashion anymore. It's not been in fashion for a while. You know, so but that's personal also.
What we're hoping to see, I suppose, and what is arriving bit by bit is for everything to become more sustainable, and not in just an eco-green kind of way, but just in the way that people purchase things and why they purchase them, and perhaps just a general consolidation of what has become an oversaturated industry and an overwatched industry, and perhaps just perspectives might become a little better aligned with reality and all the other things that are happening that fashion does comment on, but that perhaps has people have lost sight of that.
I think what needs to change is that we see fashion in a certain way, and it's not about luxurious objects, and that is just a part of it, but it's about everything. Anything we wear is fashion, and I think it should go back to that, because it's kind of become this thing where everything is about luxury and being really expensive and being really out there, but anything is fashion, like any garment is fashion. And I have this story. When I first started with the collection, the second collection I did was based about boxing and sportswear. And when that collection came out, one of my best friends won a big photography prize. So we had to go to the event when they were saying who was going to win the thing. And my best friend at the time wore a piece of the collection, and it was just a towel, because it was just this white towel with two diamante straps, but it was literally a toweling towel, a bathroom towel, and she wore it to this event, and everybody was in evening dresses, and everybody was really dressed up, and we were sitting at this table, and all these evening dresses, and there's this girl just with a towel, and it was literally just tucked in when you come out of the shower. That was the idea. And it was such an extremely extreme experience to see all these women dressed up to the nines, and there's this one girl dressed in a towel, and everybody was looking at her. And I just thought, okay, you don't need that much. Like, it's all beautiful, but you don't need to just have all the extreme stuff. A towel might be enough, and I think this is what it should go back to now. It should go back to this thing where everything can be interesting, and it's not just the Balenciaga or the Louis Vuitton or the incredibly beautiful handmade stuff. It's all, and that's what I'm missing at the moment. It's just one part of it. So I hope that's going to change.
Thank you. Do you have any other questions?
No.
No. Anyone else have a question for us? Come on. At least one more. The only one we missed was Lou.
I didn't actually bring in.
Sorry.
You got your boots.
We did decide that
the boots.
She also has her favorite boots on.
I have my boots, which I wear every day.
And a Perfecto jacket, which was also a part of the talk as well, which is crumpled up on the seat here. And Ryan's we did actually touch upon, which is the band pin that he's wearing, which might not have been as obvious, but I think we covered everybody otherwise. Frances had her book, Michelle's. Andy Warhol, my mask. Stephen's
I'm just very
hats.
Unprepared, I'm sorry.
It's my fault.
It's not your fault.
Voila. Anybody else?
Be brave.
Okay. All right, well, so I'm going to finish up there with the very last quote on the very last page, which we chose because it was hanging famously on the back wall of Louise Wilson's office, and it was something that she liked to give to her students upon graduation as a poster, I believe. And it's a far cry from the philosophy that we started with. So I'd ask my fellow speakers to actually read it with me, if you don't mind. Because
like
I think it's a bit of a group action.
Like Roxanne, you know, but with the word
if you don't mind.
We all read it together?
Yeah. Okay. Are we ready?
I think it's a good idea.
One, two, three. Believe in your fucking self. Stay up all fucking night. Work outside of your fucking habits. Know when to fucking speak up. Fucking collaborate. Don't fucking procrastinate. Get over your fucking self. Keep fucking learning. Form follows fucking function. A computer is a light bright for bad fucking ideas. Find fucking inspiration everywhere. Fucking network. Educate your fucking client. Trust your fucking gut. Ask for fucking help. Make it fucking sustainable. Question fucking everything. Have a fucking concept. Learn to take some fucking criticism. Make me fucking care. Use fucking spell check. Do your fucking research. Sketch more fucking ideas. The problem contains the fucking solution. Think about all the fucking possibilities.
Oh,
thank
man.
You very much. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you. Thank you, Dan.
Thank you,
please,
Dan.
Please
thank
come
you, Dan.
Down.
Well
thank
done.
You, everybody. Woo, woo. Thank you, my guys. Please all come down and have a look at all the books and bits and pieces.